Welcome, and we are starting the session. So today's first speaker is Dr. Ashok Udayagiri. Ashok is a faculty in University of Hyderabad, and to my good fortune, I know him for quite a long time because I joined in Hyderabad 93. You know, he was almost finishing his PhD. I distinctly remember having long discussions with him on, you know, very phase, and I think his first physics related A paper was on, you know, non-trivial aspects of very phase. I was impressed by that paper. I'm thinking of going back and reading it again because I think it may have some technological application in the context of, you know, this quantum communication. Subsequently, after finishing his PhD from University of Hyderabad in, you know, theoretical quantum optics, and by the way, University of Hyderabad was the best group at that time in optics. Professor Agarwal was there, Professor Tiwari, Professor Dutta, quite a few. And we used to attend all the seminars by them on Thursdays. Then he went to TIFR, if I believe, right? And then at Rice University, where he got into cold atoms and really put his hands on, then came back to RRI, was helping EMA and from very close quarters setting up the cold atom. They went to micro Kelvin, and then atoms did go to nano Kelvin, but not in sufficient number, if I remember correctly. And then he moved to University of Hyderabad, where he has been there. And he's, thanks to the Government of India funding from NITI Aayog, and he is the first, you know, QKD apparatus where, you know, through turbulent medium, you can pass photons, and in a hands-on experimentalist and theorist. That is the good advantage about him. So I request also to take over. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let me start sharing the screen. Okay, there it is. Then there's something this guy said I have to do something is, I'm not seeing that button here, like stop participants. Recording and all, will you chat or I have do this thing?
No, on the top of your screen there must be some view option, and there you can disable.
No, I'm not seeing that one. This is a slightly different older version of Zoom that starts out for me. Mute my audio, security, participants, new share, past share, annotate, remote control. That's what it says. Now give mouse keyboard control to others. Auto accept all requests. Problem.
Okay, so there is no option to disable attendee.
There is no option. There is no option on this one. On my this thing, it's not there. I'm running a Linux machine with a slightly older version of this thing.
Okay.
All right. Maybe I can start off with this. I will. I'll do two. So I'm assuming that everybody can see the presentation now, because this is slightly funny when it shares things. Is that okay? And when I change slide, it's changing?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
No problem.
Right. Yeah. Because sometimes it doesn't do this. I'll be seeing it. All right. First of all, I have to slightly apologize that I'm going to use a slightly, quite older slides of it, and one reason is that I didn't find anything to change on this one. So I'll have two different slide set. First slide set will show you about basics of quantum cryptography. What exactly is quantum cryptography, which is again a wrong notion, which should be correctly put as quantum key distribution. You will understand halfway through about this thing. And the second part is a very brief thing of what we did about 5-6 years ago. Unfortunately, we have dismantled that system. We'll probably get back to it a little later, maybe a year or two down, because it's all a problem of defining a very good PhD problem, and until that happens, it's kind of difficult to set it up and all that stuff. So anyway, one student took his degree and went out, and after that, we haven't got back to it. And incidentally, that student went on to work in a company in Dubai. Unfortunately, he had to be back because of this pandemic, and then he hasn't gone back after that. Anyway, so those things are on. But let me start off with this one. So, learning about quantum mechanics and about the secret codes, and these are the two basic books to look at. One is Simon Singh's code book, which is more talking about classical cryptography, how cryptography started, and a little bit about quantum cryptography. The second book is Nielsen and Chuang's book. Anyone who want to start off, the first few chapters are very, very important, where although the notations, he tries to give you quantum mechanical notations and electrical communication notations, so kind of helps understand a lot of things on that. Okay. And incidentally, both of them, especially for those students who are in India, Indian editions are available, which are inexpensive, and both of them you can buy it off quite cheap. Right. This is for those who students who don't exactly crack the whatever DJ view codes that they get it. Anyway, starting point is that everyone needs secrets. There are military secrets, there are communiques within the military thing, there are datas, photos. Military, of course, does require a lot of secure communication, but military is not the only thing which looks at secrets. There are government official secrets there, not necessarily things, your confidential reports, question papers, of course, has to be secret till it goes to, it gets open, all those issues. So there are secrets which, then there are also common man secrets. We need secrets too. I mean, our bank account numbers should be secret, credit card numbers, especially a PIN has to be secret. It should not be shared, all those things are there, right? So we also have our own personal secrets which we are worried about, especially now with all the Aadhaar card, putting everything up in the internet. One is concerned about all that. But the point is, of course, the best kept secret is when it is within you. And so a computer is very safe when you pull off the Ethernet plug and it doesn't communicate for anything else, which is what all the issue, if you remember your first Mission Impossible movie, that computer is very safe because it doesn't have, if you can't access to the computer, you cannot take data out of it. Okay, so that is the reason why all our EVMs are safe, because the EVMs don't talk to anything else. The EVM and the control machine, they're the only communication. If you can't communicate with it, you can't hack it. Simple. But that is as far as EVM is concerned, that is good. But when it comes to handling these secrets, if I keep it with myself, it's of no use. If I can have a credit card, if I say I don't give the PIN to anybody else, I can't use it at all. So, therefore, there's no point in it. But then we have to share the secret, but with authorized person. I have to share it with only that other person with whom I need to share, and not others. So the question is, how do I transmit this? And that is the main key point. How do I share a secret information with only authorized other entity? I mean, I'm not telling authorized person, the authorized party on the other side, where we two share secrets. We have to, nobody else should come to know. My bank account number or my password should be known only to the bank and nobody else. So how do we do this across, especially when we are doing, not just in the internet age, even before the internet age, we needed to do it. Okay, so spy goes into East Germany, and how do I communicate with him? That was the whole issue, if you see all those older movies. So there are two methods. One is a trusted courier, or in case of a telephone thing, it will be a dedicated phone line, which is not connected to your main telephone exchange and all. I mean, there's no, it's just a one-to-one telephone line fixed and that's it, nothing else. Or a trusted courier. And the second option is encryption. Okay. Now, the trusted courier method is that you have a message. Message does not get into somebody else's hands. Okay. Nobody else gets hold of the message. That's the idea of trusted courier. The encryption is a slightly different thing where if the message is encrypted so that if somebody gets hold of the message, he or she cannot make sense of it because the whole thing is encrypted. So that they cannot make any sense out of the message. So both of them have their own plus and minus. For an encryption, I should also have an encryption method. And for a trusted courier, I don't need to, but a trusted courier can always betray you. And or a dedicated phone line, somebody can actually tap without you knowing that it has been tapped. So this was the main issue. Now, encryption part is an extremely old thing. I mean, people have used encryption for basically you hide the message in a fashion. Just to give you examples of some very old techniques, this is something called Polybius, some Greek guy called Polybius, around 200 BC. And so what he did is you replace every letter by two letters which indicate the row and the column of the matrix. This is a more modern way of writing the Polybius square. And so, for example, G, every time you get a G, it gets replaced by T and W. Every time you get A, it gets replaced by H and D. Now, this square, it's best suited when it is random. There's no pattern in how do you find this thing. So you can create a random square and you can replace everything. So for example, for this square, the name Polybius gets replaced by something that sounds absolutely gibberish. And if you do not have access to this square, you cannot make out what this means. That is the first one. Then the whole idea is that the transmitter should also have this square. The receiver also should have exactly the same square. That is one basic requirement of this entire scheme. Julius Caesar is supposed to have made a slightly different thing. It was called the Caesar shift. Well, technically it should be pronounced as Caesar. That's the Greek Caesar thing. So let me keep calling it as Caesar rather than Caesar. It's more a French sir. So there what you do is you everything gets shifted in the right now I'm doing it for English alphabet. The Latin alphabet is not very very different. The ordering is same. So you shift the order, so A gets replaced, let's say, by C. So that is a shift of two. So every A gets replaced by C, B gets replaced by D, and so on and so forth. So this is something that's supposed to mean the Caesar shift. And if you don't know how many, I mean, if you get only this, and if I don't know how many letters it's been shifted to, and it is circular. So once you reach Z, if I want to represent Z, it gets replaced by B. So the whole thing goes in circle. And again, transmitter has to know how many letters he has shifted. You can shift it by two letters. You can shift everything by four letters. The receiver also should know. But this is easier to share rather than this, because all that Caesar has to tell the other guy, let's say 5, and then he knows that it's everything is shifted by fifth letter, so you go back 5 letters in the alphabet scheme and then you get the message. Now this is an interesting thing. For those of you who have not read it, go and read it. It's pretty interesting. It's a Sherlock Holmes mystery called The Mystery of the Dancing Man, and the story goes on to say that there's some guy who has an estate in rural England, and suddenly he starts seeing with a chalk somebody has written this kind of pictures. First he thinks it's all just this thing of vandalism, but later on he realizes where he gets worried is whenever these things are happening, his wife is getting very nervous and kind of becoming sick and all those things. So there's a connection between somebody writing these pictures and his wife getting sick. So that guy comes to, he doesn't want to ask his wife doesn't tell him anything. He comes and asks Sherlock Holmes to help him solve this. And the reason why I'm telling you this whole story is because there's a very important information hidden in this story. So the first thing, Sherlock Holmes start with the conclusion that these are all messages left there by somebody to this gentleman's wife, and this gentleman's wife can understand, but then without knowing the encryption method, how do I solve it? And that's where the brilliance of Sherlock Holmes comes in. So the second assumption he does is that this must be standard English. It's not any other funny language. Actually, he makes confirms it, telling that she doesn't know any other language other than English. She's a purebred English lady. And so therefore, now he does what is today called as a frequency analysis. In a standard grammatically correct English, we know that the maximum number of letters that comes across, if you look at how in you take any English paragraph and you count how many times each letter comes, and then you will find that the maximum one is E. E occurs most of the time in modern English. I'm looking at modern English. And therefore, what he does is he luckily gets hold of, that fellow has left many messages, like every week he leaves a message. And so he collects all these, this gentleman has written on all these pictures on a piece of paper. So Sherlock Holmes looks at it and then he says, whatever is the maximum occurring figure. So these are all stick figures. Each you can see that it's standing with in different poses. And he takes one pose which occurs maximum time. He maps that to E. Okay. Then he takes the next one and maps it to T, because that is the second most occurring letter. The third one, fourth one, like that, he goes on mapping them. And he builds the whole story now. He can decipher every message. Okay. So this is the frequency analysis part. Now, in today's sign of cryptography and decrypting, etc., this is a very, very standard practice. So you can do a frequency analysis provided you know that one. Or you look for a keyword. If you have seen the movie of this guy, Alan Turing's, the movie made on Alan Turing's life, like 2 years back it came, Imitation Game. So you will see that they know that everything has a Hail Hitler, so they try to map it to that. So there are different ways of doing it. But the frequency analysis tells you one biggest thing is that if you use the same encryption method many times, it's always vulnerable to frequency analysis. So the best thing you do is you don't use it many times. You use an encryption method you take, use it as fewer times as possible, right? So that the other guy, of course, knows how to decrypt. So that is the first basic thing which the quantum cryptography people do, is that use it only one time. Okay. So that this is the order in which maximum in which the letters occur, and E is maximum, T O I N, and so on and so forth. So you can always, and this is actually this was not meant for cryptography people, this was meant for the old printing press people, because for them they have to take out each letter and put it together. So they know that they have to maximally store this letters and then this letters and this letter. So this is the way in which they not only they store, they also kept it arranged in such a way that they can pick that letter. They won't keep it in the alphabetical order, they would keep it in this order. Okay, so idea is keep it short and simple. Okay, so that is that's the whole motto of it if you want to do any encrypted message. Then once the digital communication came up, all these people started putting out a lot of mathematical theory of it. Shannon wrote several papers about mathematical. The main first paper is called Mathematical Theory of Communication, which is a very important paper, and that's a beautiful paper where he discusses a lot of things. But in another paper, there was a second paper, most well known is about the channel noise theorem, etc. But there is something else that what was called as a Vernon cipher, which is also called as a one-time keypad. That is, I use an encryption method only once. Okay, and Shannon proved that if you use it only once, there are two conditions. One is you use the keypad only once. The second thing is you have the key as big as the message itself. Then it's very, very safe. So in the digital communication, this is how you do it. Your message is M and the encryption key is K, and you do a Boolean addition of these two, and then you get a cipher text C. And if M and K are both same length and K is used only once, then C is absolutely, it cannot be unbroken. There's no way you can break it, and provided K is perfectly random. Okay. So now the whole rest of my talk, and then there was a lot of these codes, I'll go faster. The rest of this talk is all about this key. So the idea is, how do I share the key with the authorized person without breaking into? That's why it is quantum key distribution. It's not cryptography, because the cryptography part is very standard. You just add one digital string to another digital string, and then you get one more digital string which is encrypted. Decryption is simple, because the Boolean addition is cyclic. You add the key to C, you will get back M. Okay, because the Boolean addition is cyclic, it just comes back. Now, one of the more, there are, of course, there were, this was one time keypad, this is called a Vernon cipher. And then later on, the number theory people came up with something else, where this one-time keypad is called a symmetric encryption, because it's the same thing. You use the same key to decrypt also. But in 1978, these three people, Rivers, Shamin and Adelman, who were actually mathematicians in MIT, they came up with an idea where you can use what they call as one-sided functions. So one-sided functions means f of x exists, but f inverse of x does not exist. But you can do an inverse by some other very circular method. So there is some other g of, so if y is equal to f of x, if you want to get back x, you don't do f inverse of y. G as f inverse of y does not exist, but you have to do something else. Okay, now I'll go very quickly through this because the time is a bit limited. Don't worry much about it. The main thing is it involves taking two large prime numbers, P and Q, both of them are prime numbers, both of them are 128 digit long, let us say, and then you compute N is equal to P into Q, and then you do some mathematics. This is on YouTube, you can always see it later to find out this exact mathematics, and you get a message which is a cipher text, which is M to the power E mod N. So remember that I'm doing a lot of circles with P and E. So basically what you do is your decryption is C to the power D mod N. So how this works in real life is this. Now when I log in to a let's say my bank or something like that, let us say I log into Amazon and I want to make a purchase, and when I finally come to entering my credit card details or my bank details, there's a Java backend going on in your this thing. And now the control is handed over to a third party, which is usually some trusted company like VeriSign or something like that. And what VeriSign does is, it has a large library of prime numbers. It picks up two large prime numbers, keeps one for itself, and computes N. It large, picks up two P and Q, computes N, and then computes D. And then it sends N and D to your computer. You don't know, it's all happening behind this thing. Now your computer, using a Java program, computes M using, it sends N and E, and that's what N and E are sent. And then it computes C and sends it back to VeriSign, not to Amazon. It sends it back to VeriSign. VeriSign, because it has D, it will decrypt and it will find out M, the message. You did not send M, you sent C. Your computer transmitted C. And because the VeriSign computer at the VeriSign company used P and Q, and then it sent E and N to your computer. It kept Q, from Q it computed D and kept the D with itself. And it uses D to get back M, and then it verifies M with your, these are your credit card details, and it tells Amazon that credit card details are all fine. That's all. Amazon does not know your credit card number. It does not know M, it does not know C, it does not know D. That is done by VeriSign, and of course Amazon pays a hefty fees to VeriSign to do that thing. And it helps Amazon because then you can do a lot of online transactions. If you don't trust, you don't do it. Simple. So, and the so the idea for all of you whenever you do this is to look for a lock symbol here. This is an older thing where the lock symbol used to come here. Now the lock symbol comes here. Make sure that the lock symbol is there and it is also locked. And you can always click on it and it will show you that, it will show you some big thing telling that it's verified. Sorry? Okay, I think it's just a noise somewhere. It's probably, hopefully it's not a question. So it's not exactly RSA, but it's a variation of RSA. Key, you can get information about what key is being used, etc. So that is all up to about classical cryptography, but the whole problem is this. This is a one-sided network. The whole idea about the one-sided network problem is that if I give you P and Q, you can easily find N. It takes you a few milliseconds to compute it on a computer. But if I give you N, and to find out the prime factors P and Q is very, very difficult. And especially if it's for a large number, 128-digit number, it will take several months for even a very powerful computer to find out P and Q. So your entire idea of a standard cryptography, the present day RSA scheme and its derivatives, is essentially built on the fact that it takes about 4 months for a computer today to find out P and Q from N. Because once P and Q are found, then you can find D and E. Anybody can crack, because people have access. If somebody is tapping information coming to your computer, they have access to N and E. Okay. And they can find, without knowing D, they cannot decrypt it, but they can find D if they can crack this part. So now, there's no mathematically proven that there exists no easy way. It has not yet been proven. It's not also not proven that the only way to crack RSA is to factorize, but till date, nobody has cracked it. But Shor's algorithm theoretically says that if and when we build a quantum computer, it gets lot more easier to do a factorization. So within days, I may be able to factorize it. So I may be able to crack. Somebody sitting over there may be able to crack this part. So since time is a little shorter, I'll go a little faster here. Okay, so Bennett and Brassard came up with an idea in 1984. They first time presented it in a conference on computer systems in Bangalore. At that time, computer scientists did not take it very seriously because it looks a bit counterintuitive. But later on in the 90s and then by around 2000, people started seriously looking at it. Now there are a couple of companies world over which are trying to sell quantum cryptography idea, which is originally a variation of what Bennett and Brassard gave in 1984. And then there was one more protocol came, which is, I'll tell you what is Bennett and Brassard, then there are variations which you will easily understand. So let's go back a little bit in the thing that since most of you are students starting out, some things need to make you familiar. So the way I send a data, one way is electrical pulses. So if there is this is called a transistor logic or also TTL. So if there is a 5-volt pulse, it will be digital 1. If there is no voltage, it will be digital 0. Actually, 3 volts and below is 0. So this pulses, assuming that every pulse is coming in a proper time sequence. So what I will have is this pulse sequence realizes 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, right? I can also do a fiber optic communication where it's not an electrical pulse, but light being on and off. Okay, light off means 0, light on means 1, which is what all your fiber optic things do. It has a little laser which keeps doing it. But I can do a slight variation of it. I can say I will take vertical polarization and horizontal polarization. So vertical polarization is 1, horizontal polarization is 0. So this has a big advantage because if a light pulse does not reach you, it's lost because of some reason, I will assume it to be 0. Here this is not the case, I'll know exactly that I'm not lost. This is also a light pulse, this is also a light pulse, but I have to know what is polarization. I can also take two different polarization, vertical horizontal are not the only thing, vertical, and I can take 45 degrees and 135 degrees. The whole idea is that this and this are mutually orthogonal, 90 degrees to each other. This and this are mutually orthogonal, 90 degrees to each other. So I cannot mistake this to be this. I cannot mistake this to be this. However, there is always a problem of this and this. If those of you remember your Malus law from high school will realize that if there is a polarizer coming like this and I can keep an analyzer in this fashion, I will get for cos of 45, which is 1 over square root 2, into this intensity. That is the intensity I get here. I'm talking of classical light. Okay. But when it comes to photons, whole thing becomes different, and that's the basis of it. So now let me take a standard thing. This cube is called as a beam splitter cube. Some of you would have been familiar with it. What the beam splitter does is, if I send a light intensity of I, half of I comes here and half of I comes here. So that is when I send a light of intensity I. But when I go down to quantum mechanical level, intensity is same as number of photons. So therefore, if I send 1,000 photons, about 500 of them come here and 500 of them come here. So this is exactly a coin toss experiment. If I send one photon, because a photon itself cannot be split into two, there's no half photon coming here, half photon coming here. Therefore, now the whole thing becomes probabilistic. So 50% of time the photon comes here, 50% of time the photon comes here. And offhand, I don't know which way it comes. I'll never know a priori which way it comes. And therefore, this becomes a perfect coin toss experiment. So beam photon may come here or photon may come here. With a 50-50 chance, provided my beam splitter is a perfect beam splitter. There is usually a bit of error, so probability of coming here may be 0.6 and this may be 0.4, and you have to account for it. There's a second variation of the beam splitter. It is called as a polarizing beam splitter. It does something different. This picture actually represents a polarizing beam splitter. The polarizing beam splitter, if the light is vertically polarized, it will always come out here. It will never come on this side. If the light is horizontally polarized, it will always come out here. It will never go on this plane. Okay. So a polarizing beam splitter actually separates out the polarizations, and there is no 50-50 chance here. However, if I take up a photon which is 45 degree polarized light, then Malus law says that this is intensity. If you look at Malus law classical intensity, this is I by square root 2. This is I by 2. This is I by 2. The electric field is square root 2. It's cos square theta is Malus law, not cos theta. So therefore, it's half, not 1 over square root. So it says that a 45 degree light, if I send a big beam of light, it gets equally divided between these two. And if I send a single photon at 45 degree, again it becomes probabilistic. It either comes here or it comes here. There are two issues here. One is it comes out in either of these two ports. But once it comes out, it's actually its polarization state is changed. The, what came in as a 45 degree polarized light, a photon polarized at 45 degrees, will actually become vertically polarized here, or will actually become horizontally polarized here. So this is where the entire quantum mechanics is coming. Okay, and this is where the BB84 is based on. Now, in the quantum mechanics language, you can represent it as a state of polarization, and the state of polarization can be vertical or horizontal. And it turns out that the 45 degree light is actually a superposition of vertical and horizontal, or a superposition of sigma plus and sigma minus. And therefore, when you send it through a polarizing beam splitter, there's a collapse of this wave function. It either becomes vertical or becomes horizontal. And because it's a single photon, it just comes out in it as a single photon polarized this way. The polarization state of the photon gets altered when it comes here. And that is more important. So once you know that, now how BB84 works, it probably takes another 10-15 minutes. So let me go through it fast. So, and what this is another standard thing. So we'll say A sends to B, and most of the communication people started telling instead of A send, A goes to B, they started putting names here. Alice sends information to Bob, and this is actually Alice Liddell, who was this kind of inspiration for the Charles Dodgson, Lewis Carroll's stories of Alice. And this is actually Eva Braun, but anyway, it doesn't matter. So Alice sends to Bob, and there's an eavesdropper who wants to find out the information. So this is a little bit careful you have to do. What Alice does is, Alice chooses the idea of sending polarized light. So one polarized light is one, and another polarized light is zero. What Alice does is, she takes two different bases. The vertical horizontal basis, which we sometimes call as plus basis, and the 45 degree 135 basis, which we call as a cross basis. So now what she does is, every pulse is, let us say my information is one. So I'm getting series of information. My first bit is one, and Alice decides, should I choose 45 degree or plus basis or cross basis? She randomly picks up one, let us say plus basis. And plus basis one is vertical, so she sends a vertical photon. Then the next bit is also one, let us say, second bit. Now she says, because last time I took 45 plus basis, now I take a cross basis. So in the cross basis, one is 45 degree, so I'll send a 45 degree. So I have got now, both of them are one, but I as a receiver has got a vertical photon and a 45 degree photon. Now, here is the problem. Offhand, I don't know what basis Alice is choosing. Alice, sometimes it could be plus basis, sometimes it could be cross basis. And when I do a measurement, a polarization measurement, because I cannot, because they are single photons, if it's a big bunch of photons, all of them 45 degree polarized, I can go on turning my analyzer till I get maximum, and then I can say 45 degree polarized. But I'm only getting streams of single photons. Therefore, whatever I get is the information. Therefore, what I'll do is, I will either measure in vertical basis or I'll measure in cross basis without knowing beforehand which is it. Okay. So, Bob also randomly selects it. He doesn't know what it is. And so I make measurements and save all my measurements in one place. Okay. Now what Alice will do is, Alice will publicly tell what is the basis sequence, not the bit sequence. Remember, there are two things here, basis and bit. So Alice publicly declares my basis sequence. Now I look at my basis sequence. I also have used my own basis sequence. Alice has used her own basis sequence. So now I will see which ones are matching. Any ones which are matching, I know I have got the actual measurement correctly. Anyone which are not matching, my measurement can be 50-50 this way, that way. So this is what I told you. 45 degree polarized light also can go become vertical or horizontal. 135 light also can become vertical or horizontal. That is the whole idea. Okay. And if I take a vertical polarized light and then turn my polarizing beam splitter into 135 degrees, which I am measuring 45-135, vertical can become either 45 or 135. It's a 50-50 chance. The horizontally polarized also can become 135 or 45. So if I get a 135 degree light, I don't know whether it was actually 135 degree light or it was a horizontal or vertical light. That is the whole light. I have an uncertainty of three things. It can be certain or it can be uncertain. So what essentially means, if you look at probabilities, I have out of every 4 bits, I have a probability of one of them being correct. I don't know which one, but one of them is correct. The other 3 are incorrect. Okay. So what we will do is, Alice and Bob are going to find out which ones the bases are correct, because once the basis is correct, my measurement is correct. If the basis is wrong, my measurement can be wrong. Okay, if my there's no way if my basis is correct, measurement is wrong, that is not possible. Okay. So there is a 50-50 chance of my basis being correct. Now, even if my basis is wrong, when I map my, what is wrong is 45 degree and vertical. But if I map it to bit 1, then my bit is correct. Bit may be correct, bit may not be correct if it's a wrong basis. But because there are only 2 bits, one of them is correct, one of them is wrong. So there is a 50-50 chance that I used a wrong basis, but my bit is correct. Okay. So therefore, what we will do is, what Atlas and Bob do is, wherever the basis is not matching, they will simply throw. Bit is still intact. They have not shared the bit. They have only shared the basis. Okay. Now, Eve also does not know. Bob does not know, Eve does not. So what Bob does is, let's assume that there is an eavesdropper in the middle. The eavesdropper also is trying to do this thing, but eavesdropper will say, if I, this is usually when I measure a photon, photon is gone. So what Eve will say is, if too many photons are gone, Bob will know the presence of eavesdropper. Bob should not know the presence of eavesdropper. So eavesdropper will try to hide herself by resending the photons to Bob. So if Alice sends 1,000 photons to Bob, Bob has received all the 1,000 photons, but some of them have actually gone through Eve. Eve has regenerated. But there is a 50-50 chance that Eve has regenerated a wrong bit, not the wrong photon. So this is something you need to think over, and then you will realize a little bit that this part what I have written. Eve has 75% chance of resending the correct bit, but 25% chance of getting the wrong bit. So for every 4 bits that has been sent, one of them has been wrong, provided if Eve is sitting there. So now I reverse the whole thing. Let us say I am Bob, I am receiving all the photons. And what I do is, I rework, telling that for every wrong bit I get, I know that Eve has measured 4 bits. There is an eavesdropper that measured 4 bits. There can also be channel noise. But what I'll do is, I'll take the worst case scenario. Worst case scenario is, my channel is perfect. All errors are coming because Eve is doing something there. And I know now the statistics. I turn the statistics around, telling that out of 100 bits, if I have measured, let us say, 4 wrong bits, that means I will immediately conclude that there is a finite possibility that Eve was there, and Eve has measured out of 4 into 4. So I have measured 4 wrong bits somewhere. So Eve has measured 16 bits. I don't know which bits. I don't know how much information Eve has got. But here is the point. If I get 4 wrong bits, 4 bit flips, I will assume that this is all because of Eve's measurement. And because every 4 bit flips means 16 measured bits, therefore out of 16 measure bits, 4 bit flips, 4 are wrong measurements. The remaining 12 are correct measurements. So Eve has information about 12 bits. Is that clear? So this is where the whole idea comes in. Because quantum mechanics says that every time you do a wrong measurement in a wrong basis, you leave a footprint, you're going to change the things. Eve is forced to do wrong measurements 50% of times. And therefore, Eve leaves a footprint 50% of times, and rather 25% of times. So I back calculate how much information Eve has got. Next question I ask is, how dangerous is the amount of information Eve has got? Okay, this is where classical information thing comes. I will not go through this because it's what I've already explained. There is only one little bit here which is called as a no cloning theorem. What the no cloning theorem says is, it's been wrongly understood, like you cannot make a measurement without, you cannot copy quantum state is what it says. That's not correct. You can always make copies of quantum state, but if you want to make a copy of quantum state, you have to first measure the quantum state. In a loose sense, it's like the pre-Xerox days. In the pre-Xerox days, if you want to make a copy, you have to read it and rewrite it. If you rewrite it, that means you have read it. Today, I can put it in a Xerox machine. I can keep a copy and say that I have never read it. I made a copy, I have a copy, but I didn't read it. But if I made a handwritten copy, it's not possible. If you want to copy, you have to read it. Only then you can copy. That's what it means. In quantum mechanics, if you want to make a copy, you can always clone it. But if you want to clone it, you can measure it. You cannot clone without measuring it. Okay. This is a mathematical statement of it. Don't worry about that part. Okay. Then there are things called quantum non-demolition measurements, where you do a partial measurement. You don't completely measure. The whole idea is that if you measure in the same basis, you are going to leave the state unchanged. If you are measuring in a different basis, every time you take your x and p, you know this part, right? Every time you measure in a different basis, you are going to meddle with the quantum mechanical wave function. But you can do your quantum non-demolition measurement insists on a series of partial measurements, so you don't really disturb the system. But then you also get only a partial information. If you want to get more information, you have to do several partial measurements, which at the end of which you would have disturbed the system. So the main idea of BB84 stands in the fact that if there is an eavesdropper, the eavesdropper is making a measurement, that eavesdropper has to leave a footprint, number one. Number two, if by looking at that footprint, I can estimate how much information eavesdropper has. Now I come to the classical idea of, this is the same thing, but look at the third. Now, this is the mutual information between Alice and Bob. Mutual information means the same information, how much they have. This is a set theory idea, the way Shannon put it, but the best way to understand it is Alice has some information, Bob has some information, and Bob's information, because Alice has transmitted it, there'll be errors in it. You look at how much Alice and Bob are matching. Okay, that percentage is the mutual information. Then you also look at how much Eve has extracted information. How much of that is mapping with Eve? I don't know at this point what it is, because I have not met Eve, but assume that I meet Eve and I get that information also. And then you see how much is matching. The standard Shannon's mathematical theory says that if Alice-Bob mutual information is much greater than Alice and Eve's mutual information, that is, how much Eve has information, how much Bob has information, then Alice and Bob can use classical error correction codes to improve the fidelity. The whole idea is this. The classical error correction codes are done over public. Okay. And the quantum channel is only a small channel where you are sending quantum bits. And therefore, Alice and Bob, we have done, I'll show you in a minute some interesting simulation results of it. If Alice and Bob, both of them use the same error correction codes, then both of them are improving the fidelity of their codes. You have to remember one thing, that all your present day information system, so simply take your CD driver, for example. When your CD driver reads the CD, because it does it in such a high speed, there are a lot of errors. Before showing it to you, your computer is doing a huge amount of error correction codes, standard error correction codes that are built in, the algorithms are built in. That is why when you use a scratched CD, some CD drivers can show it to you, some CD drivers cannot show it to you, because those who are showing it to you are actually doing a better error correction code. And you will also realize sometimes that it gets stuck. It shows you a lot of pixels and then comes properly because it's doing a calculation of the error correction codes. But that was all as far as, it was not considering with the cryptography, it was all considering with how do I improve the fidelity of information. Now the cryptographers use that information and say that both Bob and Eve are going to use the error correction codes, but Eve has more information, Eve has as much information as Bob, then both of them have the same advantage. Bob has an advantage only if he has more information than Eve has. Okay. So now that comes back. Because why that this idea is important. Now what you are going to tell is that if Eve has more information than a threshold amount, I will assume that my quantum key distribution channel has been compromised. I don't know whether Eve is there or not, but if simply the noise level goes beyond a threshold, I'll simply assume that there was an eavesdropper and my channel is compromised. Therefore, I'm not going to use the key. Remember, I have not sent the message yet. Message is still safe with me. I was only sharing the key. So I'll redo the whole procedure again till such a time that I find that my key has not been compromised. It is safe. So once it has been safe, I'll do classical error correction. I'll improve the fidelity of the key. Now I'll do a classical encryption and send off the whole message across. Encrypted key. Why all this circus? Because now I am able to generate a key just before my communication scheme. I am able to share, suppose I am Alice, I am able to share the key with the Bob very safely, and I ensure the safety of the key has not been compromised, and then I'll do a classical encryption and use it. And I use it only once for a short message. Next time I want to send another message, I will use the whole process again. Okay. The rest of it is already explained in most of the book. What I have not told you, what I am telling you, explained to you, is something which I don't find often repeated in most of the books. This part has been there pretty much, you can find enough literature about this. Even Nielsen and Chuang tell you this much. And Gissa, this is a review paper by Nicola Gissa on quantum cryptography. He also tells you, that's in Review of Modern Physics in 2006. That also tells you enough information. Okay, so this is the main part. Error correction happens in public channel. If Eve's information is more than Bob's, this procedure helps Eve more than it helps Bob. Okay, so if there is more noise, you abandon the protocol and start up. Now, of course, what Eve does is that Eve is not going to measure everything, because it's going to compromise Eve's position. So if there's too much of noise, you know that Eve is measuring. So Eve tries to measure as minimal as possible, because she doesn't want to leave too much of footprints, but at the same time get maximum information. And two people, Shore and Preskill, did a lot of calculation using this Shannon entropy. Shannon entropy, anyway, this things will be shared with you, so you can actually re-look at this. Because I'm already 11 o'clock, so I'm not going to go too much on this part. Shannon entropy, it's called Shannon entropy because it looks like your Boltzmann entropy. Okay. Shannon was trying to calculate what is the probability that if I toss a coin, it will be one or heads or tails or one or zero. And if I toss 10 coins, will it be, what is the probability? So Shannon entropy, like your, don't look at entropy as an idea of disorder because that will give you a misinformation here. But look at the way Boltzmann writes his omega log omega. So he's actually telling you that if you have a system, a classical thermodynamic system, he's trying to find out what is the maximum distribution in different energy states. And therefore, you can, if you calculate partition function, you are going to find out what is the energy contained in the system. So in a similar way, Shannon entropy tells you what is the maximum information contained in a system. Maximum allowed information, not the actual information. Okay. And earlier they were not using it for cryptography. Now cryptographers find out that if I use the same Shannon entropy and what is called as a Holover bound on Eve's measurement, I can get an estimate of Eve's maximum information. So using that, and that, for that there's a classic paper by Shore and Preskill, S-H-O-R and P-R-E-S-K-I-L. If you can look at it, the mathematics is worked out there. And they found out that 17% noise rate per qubit will be a limit, upper bound, such that the idea is that if I see a 17% noise rate in my communication, and assuming that all this noise is coming because of Eve's measurement, then I do an upper bound on Eve's, how much information Eve has, and that will turn out to be Bob and Eve has the same information. A Holover bound will be 0.5. So if I get 17% noise, I am going to assume that Eve has as much information as Bob has. So I am going to abandon the protocol. So 17% is a limit for abandoning the protocol. Okay. You have to restart fresh. Of course, this does not prevent Eve being a simple mischief maker. Eve can keep on measuring and make sure that Alice and Bob never share the information and be happy. Eve is happy, Alice and Bob are unhappy. But on the other hand, if Eve is also not benefited because nobody shares the information. So that can always be done. What is otherwise called, in computer language, it's called denial of service. So I simply make sure that you two don't communicate, that's all. I will not get the information. But I am not benefited either. The second option is that I will try to get as much information as possible, and therefore I'm going to betray my presence. So Alice and Bob will abandon the whole protocol and start afresh. The von Neumann entropy is a quantum mechanical level of Shannon entropy. Those of you who have done quantum mechanics course will immediately see this is same as your density matrix to a wave function relation. The density matrix is out of product wave function, and this will also involve coherence between information and all those kind of things, and that will give you a little more information about the information content. Those who want to get deeper into mathematical principles of information and how do you play around with it, go a little deeper in this. But today I just wanted to show you again. But here is the most important thing, which is what preventing all of us to use BB84 outright. So although it's a beautiful thing, the first part is the entire BB84 protocol is defined in case of single photon sources, because only a single photon at a 45 degree beam polarizing beam splitter will come out as vertical or horizontal, or a vertical single photon vertically polarized, or horizontally polarized with by beam splitter turned 45 degree will come out vertical or horizontal. It does not account for if I don't have a single photon. As two photons at 45 degree have a chance of either coming vertical or horizontal. The whole problem is that if takes out one of those photons and sends you other photon, you will never know Eve has been there. That is the main problem. But laser per se is not a single photon device. This is something that those of you who have done a course on laser physics will understand that actually quantum optics will understand that lasers are actually a Poissonian distribution. That is, the number of photons at any given time in a laser pulse follows a Poisson distribution, which means there is, when I go down to very low level, there's an equal probability of getting zero photons, one photon and two photons. And you will never notice this in a day-to-day life because normally laser has 10 billion photons, a few missing here and there. But it's a Poisson distribution. So, this is vulnerable to beam splitter attacks. The second equally important problem is today everything has to go stick in the existing fiber. The existing fiber is sitting at 1300 or 1500 nanometer telecom band because this is where a silica fiber has least amount of dispersion. Anywhere else it has a much bigger dispersion. The problem comes is measuring a few photons when I send single photons. So there are things called avalanche photodiodes, as Professor Agarwal keeps telling in every this thing, there is no true photon counting device. You never have a single photon counter, but what you have is, what he means is that if two photons come together on an avalanche photodiode, it will measure it as a single photon. But more importantly, the worst part is this, that normal silicon photodiodes have an efficiency of about 50%. That means if you send 100 photons through a silicon photodetector, avalanche photodetector, it will measure only 50 of them randomly. The remaining 50 will just go through photodiode. But silicon photodiodes work only in visible range. The problem is worse when it comes to the telecom band, because InGaAs photodiodes and germanium photodiodes are even lesser efficiency, 15% and 20%. That means you send 100 photons, I measure only 20% of 20 of them. If you send 15 photons, I measure only 15 of them. Just to give information, what is this avalanche photodiode is, like every photo, it's like your, if you have understood photo multiplier tube, this is a semiconductor version of it. For every photon that falls on it, it creates a single electron and that electron gets multiplied. At the end, it gives you a huge pulse, which you can measure. Single electron is also difficult to measure, but a pulse gets measurable. But every time, if two photons comes together, they get mixed up and it gives you only one pulse. If two photons come slightly apart, it'll give you two pulses. Anyway, but the whole problem is efficiency part of it. And there has been a workaround suggested that you mix 1550 photon with a 980 nanometer photon in what is called as a frequency upconvert, I mean some frequency generation. Which is or a difference frequency in this case. No, this is some frequency. Inside a crystal it has to happen, but that has its own efficiency. So it's like 35% efficiency. I see some name Harish going around, maybe as a chat. I'll answer your question a little later. Okay. I don't see chats on this. I'll have to come out of presentation to see chats. I'll see that one a little later. Let me finish this thing. Then that is as far as fibers are concerned, and this is what is called as a free space part, and this is attenuation of light in the free space, in atmosphere, and you find that most of them gets transmission drops down in most PLN because they either get scattered or absorbed. However, luckily there is a window here, 800 nanometer to 900 nanometer. But what is not shown is this. There is a window beyond 1500 nanometer. So, but 1500 nanometer silica photodiodes work. In free space, I can use this. Silica photodiodes work, but free space has its own problems. I'll tell you later. I'll come to the concluding part of this presentation, and there are three more slides in other one. I'll open that and show you. There are two, three companies. There is right now an Indian company called QNU Labs. Started out with a set of people from IIT Madras, and now it has its own set of people. So they are all claiming that they will give you a plug and play instrument. You can simply plug your telecom thing and it's going to use fiber optic network to do the QKD. The only difference here is it's going to use a slightly different protocol. It's not going to use polarized lights. It's not going to use polarization as the mapping part. It's going to use the delay between two photons as the mapping part, because most fibers don't maintain polarization. And it's going to do a phase information. It's going to mix two photons and get a phase information. That's a slightly different protocol. Don't worry about this. This was an old slide talking about it. This is the same thing, and this is a 2002 review of modern physics, quantum cryptography. This is a good book too, good paper to start with. And of course, the books are more important. And this is a mathematical theory which gave the beginning of mathematics. Okay, I'll briefly go through the next slides, and then I will. There seems to be a lot of questions. I'll quickly take up the questions and then go to. Maybe entire page is not visible. I'm not sure what happened. I don't know. Some people have to be seeing it. If it's measured and cloned, would the quantum state be not lost? No, I can. Yes, that is the main point. Yes, that is the main point. That if it's measured, I'm measuring, go back to your Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian. If it's in the same basis, then the state is a stationary state of the Hamiltonian, nothing happens to the state. But if I'm measuring with a different Hamiltonian, I'm disturbing the state. Okay, that is the main idea. Photon being lost, yes, photon gets lost, but I can always recreate it once I know the state of the photon. Ajay Samal question, why do we use a capture code? Capture code is not to do with it. Capture code is just to make sure that you are not a computer, you are a human being. Okay. Sir, this is a long-term secure solution. Yes, as of now, long-term secure solution. Till a very usable quantum computer comes and somebody can run a Schwarz algorithm and break a 128-bit code, well. Till then, maybe another 10 years is what I'm going to look at, probably. Till then, it'll be there. Okay. Janaki Parvaditya, direct message. I'm not sure. I can't see the message. I don't know how to see this message. I'll pick it up a little later. But let me start one more thing. I'll just take you... 5 minutes, and then we can have more discussions. Janaki probably will have to chat in again, and then we'll pick that up. Just give me 2 seconds, because my office program takes a little time to do it. In between, you can ask Shyam Sahu. What exactly the backward security? Backward security is, I'll tell you what is a backward security in this when I show you my presentation. Okay, so what we had built up many years ago, unfortunately we have dismantled, is this. Let me again go back to share my screen. let me close this guy. Share screen. Slideshow, stats from first slide. Okay, I'm assuming that you can all see this thing. And here what happens is that we have four different lasers, laser 1, 2, 3, 4, I'll talk about five. And if these two lasers will fire, the light comes out, every time I see my information, one of these four lasers will fire. And if it is a zero, either this will fire or this will fire. If it's one, this will fire or this will fire. And so this, all of them are polarized in different way, vertical polarized, horizontal. No, there's a halfway plate here. So this will be 45 degrees, 135 degrees. This will be horizontal, vertical. So depending on whether it is zero or one, 45 or vertical, if it's zero, or if it's one, 135 or horizontal will fire. And that comes over here, and there's a filter to reduce the intensity, and it will come over here. This is the Alice part. This is the Alice part. This is the Bob part. In the Bob part, the photon will either go here, and this, because there is a halfway plate here, this is a 45-135 measurement, and it either comes here. This is a regular beam splitter. If it 50% chance it will go here, or 50% will come here. So it will either become a 45-135 measurement, or it becomes a vertical horizontal measurement. The fifth laser fires along synchronously with any of these lasers, so this becomes a trigger laser, and this will keep watching. It will make a measurement only if there is a trigger. If there is no trigger, it won't record the measurement. Okay. So I know I'm synchronizing all the measurements. And there is a back communication also. And this was how it was set up at those times. There are four avalanche photodiodes. This was meant to be free space and not... we had some technical issues with this guy, so we had to dismantle this part. And what we did is, we went through our own protocol. You know, we did a lot of handshaking protocol. These are all classical, these are all goes through classical channel. So the laser 5 and laser 6 also becomes my classical communication, because they're not filtered. They go in a full blown. These are diode lasers, and low power, but not few photons. Okay. Whereas once I filter it, I'm getting only maybe one photon or five photons or six photons at that time. Okay. So this, all this acknowledgement, handshaking and all goes through in the standard classical channel. We built up all those things. And then what happened is, we did a little bit of experiment where we said that we put a chamber in the middle, we created fog and smoke in it, and we wanted to measure polarization. So we went out of the quantum channel, we went only through classical channel. We saw how much of degradation happens, and we did some circus to measurement, what is called as differential measurement. We found that my bit error rate is almost zero for a very, very large amount of this optical depth here. Zero means no smoke or no fog. The higher optical depth, minus 30, means very large amount of fog, so my intensity is falling down very large. But don't worry about these things, these are for, this is the most part. So what we did is, we did a simulation. In the simulation, we sent about 10,000 random bits. We added randomly how much Eve causes noise level, and we did a Hamming code and to improve the fidelity. Now this is error before doing Hamming code between Alice and Bob, and this is error after doing Hamming code. The green line says there is no error. Okay, the amount of this thing should be same. Sorry, rather the error, nothing has happened to the error. if you can see that there are some strange cases where error increases by doing Hamming code, but most of the time error decreases, but error does not decrease to zero. As the errors increase, the amount of, after doing error correction using Hamming code, I'm still left with a lot of errors. Error is decreased, but still there are a lot of errors. But if the error codes are very small, if the amount of error is very small, the Hamming does a fantastic error correction and my error becomes almost close to zero. That is most important. That is important. But here is the point. What if Eve also uses the same error correction code? What happens to her information? Now it turns out that if Eve has made very few measurements and then she uses the error correction code that Bob is using, her error does not improve much. These red things are Eve's errors after error correction. Remember, notice that it's still sitting on the straight line. What I showed you, that big thing is here. Okay. So Bob can manage to correct most of his errors simply because Bob has more information than Eve. And Eve, although can get a lot of information, at best she can get 50%, her fidelity does not improve. Her error is still 1. Error percentage is still 1. 100% error. And this is a slightly different manifestation of the same thing. So these are all our initial simulations. Now I have started rewriting the whole simulation. I'm writing a Python code to do the whole simulation. This was actually, we used LabVIEW to do error correction and all the things. So I'm doing the whole thing on LabVIEW. Is actually not meant for this. LabVIEW is meant for doing connecting data from experimental setup. I'm hoping I'll get more of this. This was not published at all, but once the Python thing comes out, I'm sure I can actually publish that part well better. So I'm sorry I've taken a little longer part of it. So I just wanted to give you a flavor of what happened, what Professor Panigrahi said, that I'm one of the earliest guys to set this up in India, set up an experimental setup. Of course, now there are more people who have gone much further than I have. I have been a bit slow on it because I keep doing a lot of other things also. I get distracted a bit easily, and then once my student takes a degree and goes off, I don't put another student on the same thing. I'll probably pick this up again and I'll do a much better job. Okay, so I will close here my presentation, and we have another 20 minutes to go and discussion. What exactly backward security works is this. That is, once I have all the information, can Eve also use that information to recreate the code? This was one of the biggest, somebody put up this challenge in one of the presentations. Hamming code has something called a syndrome set. I have to send this, Alice has to create the syndrome set, has an information and uses the syndrome set to build the information. But some mathematician said that can do a probabilistic, go back and build the information itself using the syndrome. It has not been proven. It may be possible. That is a backward security. So how do I prevent that to happen? After I get the information, can Eve also get some information? Is there any other protocol besides BBPro84? Yes, there are now significant number of protocols. The immediate protocol that came, BB84, stands for Bennett Brassard 1984. Brassard put up something independently at 1992 called B92. That has been more used. I'll come to Abidin's question of using four things. Let me first put up this BB84. So that was called B92. B92 is more used now. That's slightly better off. There are more other protocols like Eckert protocol and plenty of other things. So BB84 is still a classic protocol which is used like today to understand the whole basis of QKD, why it is significant. Then there are a lot of other better protocols which are more efficient, which has been used now. Okay. And I need to do a lot of exploration. Some of them I myself haven't gone beyond this thing. Now, both Abhidin's question, what is using four laser source, is that I can use a single laser source and keep on changing my polarizer. That's a bit slow. Firing four different laser source as 01 and 01 keeps coming is much faster, so much more efficient. Okay. And there are also problems that if I'm running the analyzer, it can go slightly off. It may not exactly sit at where it has to sit, because there's always a little bit of, my motor is turning, it can go a little off on the other side. So fixing four laser sources and firing them as and when I require is much more efficient way of doing it. And now Dadi Kamal Kamlesh says that if I'm using more basis sets, is it be useful? Yes, six state protocol is supposed to be better than a four state protocol. You have a whole circle, you can go on doing a lot of them. But then there is a point reaches where I cannot distinguish between this and this. Okay. So that my resolution, that depends. You can do an eight state protocol. You can do a, you can go on in numbers of powers of two, which will be the best thing. But then my electronics becomes more and more complicated. My measurement system becomes also more and more complicated. So I'll have to account for all. I need more optics. Becomes expensive, right? So that is all. Yes, I'm going to increase fidelity. So now you do a trade-off. Cheaper, less fidelity, expensive, more fidelity. In quantum cryptography, why are we more interested in a key distribution, not an encryption algorithms? Because Wernham-Cipher, which is the simplest encryption algorithm, is mathematically proven to be the most secure, provided I use the key only once. Okay. Anything else, your encryption algorithms, you have a trade-off. The more better encryption, yeah, it's more difficult to crack, but not impossible to crack. Whereas Wernham-Cipher is impossible to crack. So that hope answers Shripana's question. Right, any more? Good, it's nice you're asking a lot of questions, and I should say questions are very, very critical questions, and not like how I use some lasers and all. I mean, this is more the kind of questions that one we will look for. So I would look at an ideal system is where I use layers of systems where I will share the key, not exactly, okay, how can give one key to the only authorized person? That is where all the handshaking protocol comes. So I do a classical handshaking protocol to first ensure that you are my authorized fellow, I'm talking only to the authorized guy, and then I do a QKD with you to make sure that key is only with you. Well, there is always a problem that you can, what do you use the word, you can come in and somehow convince me that you are the author. Somebody else convince me that he is the authorized person. Then of course everything is lost. Masquerade. You can masquerade as an authorized person, everything is lost. Okay, so coming back to Shripana's question, so the best way I would look at it is that I have a collection of encryption systems, and not necessarily always one keypad, and I will use, depending on the situation and how much encryption I want, the more encryption I want, I go on building more and more security things. not everything needs to be as secure as, right? Certain things need not be as secure. So I would envisage a system, an ideal system is where I have switches before communicating, and I will decide how much encryption level I want to go, and it builds that much of encryption. So now you realize that my handshaking protocol also has to be very trustworthy. Okay. I can somebody can masquerade and then steal all the key from me. I may not be giving it to the real Bob. I'm giving it to a real Bob. And this is what happens, no? I think I'm giving it to some secret. I'm sharing it with. If you read all your espionage novels, Tom Clancy or John Le Carre and all, you will find something very funny. I think I'm giving it to a guy who is actually from South Africa. I'm helping a South African guy, but it ends up in Syria or Lebanon later. Okay, so espionage problems. So read a lot of espionage novels and you will find some very interesting problems. Also, nuclear codes are encrypted using QKD right now? Not yet. Right now, it's typed and put in a sealed cover and sent to the other guy. where I see QKD coming in as of now is exactly in mostly not in the military part, but more in the civil part, where I want to send an information to Geneva, to my banker, Swiss bank. That's where I kind of envisage it at this point. Nuclear codes, yes, you would want to do it if once we, I wish we don't do it, wish we don't go to that stage, but if I have a nuclear weapon sitting in a satellite and I want to launch it, I hope we don't reach that stage. But if it happens, yes, I'll have to use an QKD encrypted launch code over there. As of now, guys taking a set of codes and you have to see this movie called Dr. Strangelove, which is where I took that first line of this, my presentation, if you recollect this. This comes from Dr. Strangelove. The second title is actually the second title of Dr. Strangelove. It says how I stopped worrying about nuclear codes. why is it not going to the first line? This thing, how I learned quantum mechanics and stopped worrying. It's a rehash of that thing. If you look at that Dr. Strangelove, you will find out that, sorry, I did something and it came a scratch thing on that. I don't know how to do it. You will see how he sends you. I think somebody else is writing on my screen. Okay, doodling. So he will tell you how the nuclear codes is. So he will say code number so and so. You open the envelope, there the codes are written. In these days, key distribution depends. Yeah, your OTP is actually a single key distribution. Yes. Yes. One time password is a thing, but somebody can steal it if they have access to your cell phone channel. You can always masquerade. Somebody else can also get your OTP. In fact, that is what one of the cheating things. He will call you and say that by mistake he has put your phone number and it has sent OTP to you. Can you actually please share? But he is doing something nonsense over there. He has access to your bank account. Don't, if somebody calls you and says that by mistake I have sent, put your phone number, can you please share the OTP that you got, tell him no, I want to, you redo it. Okay, thank you, right. Yeah, thank you, you are welcome, Valjinder, and so 11:31, and I think we need to stop and we have to go for the other talk. Maybe I have 2 spare minutes. You're welcome, all of you. Thank you, Johnny. You're welcome. Right. Thank you, Shripana.
Yes. So, because wonderful.
Yes.
I myself enjoyed it quite a bit.
Okay, thank you. Right.
And if there's a popular request, we may request you to give some kind of a leisurely tutorial some other time.
Sure, yeah, a leisurely tutorial later. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, so, thank you very much.
Now, Professor R.P. Singh will join.
Okay, good. My convey my hellos to him.
Sure.
I have to go attend some other meetings.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ashok. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
You have made my life simpler.
Oh, okay.
Than
good. Everything. Okay. Good. Good. Now you can go on directly telling what you have done.
Let's see.
Yeah, I wanted to stay back, but I have to go and do some funny business. So I'm off with you. Yeah. Bye. I'm leaving off. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, good. You're studying in Dekai. Good.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.
Hi, Professor Panigrahi.
Nirmalya, is it? So RPG, yeah. I am. Nirmalya is around. So.
Okay.
Nirmalya is.
Nirmalya is going to do introduction.
Yes.
Yeah. Hi. How are you, RPG?
I'm fine. Thank you, Nirmalya.
Yeah, nice to again see you. So you came, of course, last year. I think this pandemic year is kind of, I'm forgetting. So you came here in our the other conference, and we were very happy to host you that time.
No, last time we came for Viva, your students Viva.
Yeah,
that was
Viva
the last. Last visit.
RPG, let me give you good news. Malia got a science paper.
Wow, great. Badhaiyo, congratulations.
Thank you.
Very nice.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so should we now start slowly?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah, you can start, yeah.
Yeah, so let me just quickly introduce Professor R.P. Singh. Of course, I will not take long time in introducing him. So Professor R.P. Singh, as you know that, of course, all of you know, and whoever are particularly working in optics and also in this area of quantum information. So all of you are familiar with Professor R.P. Singh, Professor Ravindra Prakash Singh. So he is, of course, a professor at Physical Research Laboratory, and he works, of course, in many areas involving quantum information and quantum state tomography. Particularly, he uses, of course, using light, and particularly using angular momentum states of light, vortex beams, etc. And he has done extensive work in the context of understanding various effects related to the angular momentum of light, and are not necessarily confined to quantum optics or to only quantum information, but in many areas, even in classical optics, and also, of course, in the context of quantum entanglement using the higher order these vortex modes. There are many things that he has been working on using higher order vortex modes, point gradients, etc. There are a lot of stuff he can go through. Personally, of course, I had the pleasure to interact with him now almost touching 20 years. I remember it was this early part of this millennium that when I was, of course, very young, and Professor R.P. Singh was also younger, I visited his lab and I also did some experiment in their lab, which eventually led to some publications. And since then, of course, we are always in touch. As I said, that he last time came, he was saying that for the Viva, our student, and then also we had another conference, he came, and in QIQT also last time he visited. This time, of course, visit is not possible due to this pandemic situation. So it is always a pleasure to have Professor R.P. Singh here. So without any further wasting time, I give it to Professor R.P. Singh. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Nirmalya. Thank you, Prasanji, for asking me to give the talk. But before I talk about free space quantum communication or anything else, I will start with something different. So, my son, who is going to college, 5-year law college, who did joining school. So just 10 days back, he got up early morning, 8 a.m. that is early for him. And all of a sudden he says, I'm thinking of dropping for this year. I asked, why, what happened? He says, this online, if it is going to be online, I'm not going for college. I will drop. So I'm fed up with this online thing. So that is the kind of young students who are online, they are, the way they are fed up. They are thinking even of dropping 1 year of the college. So I'm telling you my personal experience with my son. So I don't know how you guys are coping up with this online seminars, online courses, too much of online load. I think, in my opinion, looks like people are fear of missing out. If somebody is organizing, I should also organize. Or something should keep on going, like people are sitting, corona, they are not able to meet, they are not able to talk to each other face to face. So something should be going on, that's why these things are going. This online business, of course, this is not equal to face-to-face seminar when you talk to guys sitting before you. This kind of thing is very dehumanizing. You are talking to a machine. Or I don't know, sometimes I may fall asleep while talking to machine. So please wake me up. Okay. So with this preliminary I should start talking about quantum science technology and free space quantum communication. So we have in PRL, we have quantum science and technology program. You see there. So this is quantum science and technology program, and we have many labs as well as a theory group under this quantum science and technology program. We have quantum technology lab where we have many members. We have a good number of students and PDFs. Then we have another lab. You can see that. If we go. So we have photonic sciences lab. Then, okay. I'm not good at this. Okay. Let me go to June. Okay, so we have many more labs, photonic sciences lab, atomic physics theory, we have attosecond physics lab. Attosecond physics lab, they are controlling the wave packet. Okay, in real time, you can control the wave packet, and controlling the wave packet, you can change the molecular reaction, you can create new molecules, okay. And then you can verify, one of the immediate application of quantum computers is to simulate the molecules. Okay, so you can verify those simulations in lab. Once you have this kind of technique, you have control over the wave packet dynamics, and you can control the wave packet in molecular reaction. So photonic sciences lab that works in quantum metrology, Ångermantel interferometer, two photon interferometer. We are working in quantum communication and quantum sensing also. And then luminescence lab, that is very old lab, very good lab. They have done very pioneering work in luminescence dating. And luminescence, it is based on defect centers in crystals. So they are gearing up towards nitrogen vacancy centers in diamonds and other defect centers in different crystals for quantum sensing. So we have good number of labs which are engaged in this kind of quantum science and technology. So we have very vibrant program. We have good number of PhD students and PDFs. So with this is the introduction about PRL, and you are always welcome to PRL. You can visit, although this is Corona and we are not allowing any visitor to come to our guest house. But once it is over, you can come and visit us. So how to go for quantum communication, okay? It's quantum communication, it's vast area. It includes like quantum teleportation, quantum repeaters, okay, entanglement swapping, you can say, and quantum network, quantum internet. There are so many things that comes with quantum communication. So these kind of things require a single photon source or entangled photon source. Okay. And physical variables, one can use polarization, time arrival of photons, momentum, angular momentum, orbital momentum, linear momentum, energy. There are so many variables one can use, physical variables, as to form the quantum state. And for making the keys, as Ashok has talked about quantum key distribution, I will also be talking about quantum key distribution. And once you have the key, you can use masses and you can make your masses secure. So single photons or entangled photons can be communicated to free space or optical fiber. Both you can use so that for quantum communication. As you know that all our present day communication is being done through optical fibers, and satellite is there for free space communication. However, with current optical fiber and photon detector technology, its quantum communication is limited to the order of few hundred kilometers because there is inherent attenuation. Like base of the fibers, 0.2 dB per kilometer, they will have attenuation. So you can't go for very long distances if you are using optical fiber. So you will have to go for satellite if you want to go for long distance quantum communication. It's not moving to the next screen. Okay, now it has moved. So quantum key distribution, it's a very successful application of quantum communication. Okay, as I told, quantum communication is a vast area, so many things are included, but this quantum key distribution is one of the very successful application of quantum communication. And most of the work in quantum communication is being done in this area for the time. Okay. So, and I will be also talking about this quantum key distribution only for this talk. And as Ashok already explained everything about RSA algorithm, and this quantum computers can break that algorithm because Peter Schwarz algorithm, he talked about Peter Schwarz algorithm, how one can do the prime factorization very quickly using quantum computers. I think all these quantum computers, work on quantum computers started because of Peter Schwarz algorithm, because he developed a quantum algorithm and showed that it can break this RSA encryption scheme very fast compared to classical computers. So, and this providing security, the distribution of key needs to be secure, as Ashok explained very nicely. This distribution of the key needs to be secure, and that is done by because we are using quantum mechanical principles, okay, to distribute the key, and that's how you make it secure. Classically, classically, if somebody is doing hacking, okay, so you can't make out, but here in quantum mechanics, if you're using quantum mechanical principle, so if anybody is trying to hack this encryption key, when you are distributing the encryption key, this key, you can make out somebody is hacking. But if you are doing this key, suppose you are sending from one person to another through optical fiber channel, instead of like, as Ashok explained, you just seal it, you make a key, you write the key, you seal it and send by in person. One person takes it and delivers to the other, that's fine. But suppose you want to send through the fiber this key, so it can be encrypted, okay? So it can be broken. Some hacker can take the key and you cannot notice that, okay? It's quite possible. So quantum key distribution ensures sending key is sending key securely between communicating devices using principles of quantum mechanics. So why I'm saying again, principles of quantum mechanics, that is very important. So you can use quantum state and then you use quantum mechanical principles, and using that quantum state and quantum mechanical principles, you can make the key. So these are the two very popular key distribution protocols, BBAT4 and BBM92 protocol. One is prepare and measure. You prepare correlation states, okay, in different basis, two mutually unbiased basis in this prepare and measure. And similarly, another party that measures. One party prepares and sends it, and another party measures. That's how you have to keep between two parties, this security. In entanglement-based protocol, you have entangled photon source, two photons. You communicate to two parties, Ellis and Bob, and then they measure same way as in BB84, this polarization state. There are other protocols in entanglement-based as well as in prepare and measure, but these are the most popular. Like in entanglement-based, you have Picard-91 protocol, and where you, along with measuring this polarization state like BB84, you do the Bell state measurement. Bell inequality also you verify. Bell measurement you do and verify the inequality, Bell's inequality. We'll talk about what is Bell's inequality. And But because you are using large number of polarization states for this verifying the Bell inequality, key generation rate or number of keys you generate per second, that becomes lower, much lower. That's why people have gone for BBM-92 protocol. Similarly, along with BB84, Ashok has already pointed out, B92 protocol is there. But BB84 protocol is supposed to be more secure. There is the rigorous security proofs are there for BB84 protocol. That's why it's more popular. Along with BB84 protocol, we have decoy-state protocol, some modification of BB84 protocol, and that gives you larger number of keys and makes it more secure. So, as I told, what is the motivation of this free space quantum communication? So you have to go for satellite quantum communication. That is the ultimate free space quantum communication. So you can have entangled photons as well as a weak coherent pulse. Okay. So you can have both weak coherent pulses as well as entangled photons for using satellite for quantum key distribution. So your entangled photon source is sitting in the satellite, photon 1, photon 2. Okay. It sends two photons, two entangled photons, and you do the measurement, polarization state measurement, and by then basis selection, proper basis selection, match, proper basis matching, you generate the key. And here, this is trusted. When you take the satellite as trusted, untrusted, you can take satellite as untrusted device when you are using entangled photon source for quantum key distribution, but you can use weak coherent pulse like BB84 protocol, and here you have to take satellite as a trusted device. And here what you do, first you generate a key, you exchange this polarization state, okay, generate key KA, and then you go to the satellite, establishes a key with another station KB, okay, K and KB, and now you have K and KB, then you do the XOR thing, and then you get the KA here, or you can get the KB. So just XOR operation will give you the key. So you can have, because satellite is having both, so you do the encryption and this XOR thing and send it. KA, KB you send, K and KB this XOR, and this is having KB, so it will have KA by XOR operation. And here again, K and KB, you are sending XOR after operation, satellite is sending, and then it operates like another KB and KA, and it will get KB. So that is the idea. So you can have both kinds of communication, a QKD, quantum key distribution, using satellite. Why is it going? Okay. So this will be the outline of the talk. Security of QKD, okay, I will tell basic, okay, and then introduction to BB84 protocol again. Ashok has given a lot of detail, I will cover it quickly. Then physical implementation, attacks on QKD, okay, very simple attacks, and then decoy state protocol, very briefly. Then protocol in the lab, how we have done that, I will tell you the scheme and what is the result. Then BB84 protocol in the field for 200 meters free space quantum communication, that I will discuss experiment and results. Then BBM-92 protocol again, 200 meters, we have I will show you where we are doing this experiment. It was fun and thrill, okay, to do the experiment in the field. And then I will summarize and what experiments we can do in immediate future. So how you get security in quantum key distribution? You use mutually unbiased basis. Okay. So if you're using mutually unbiased basis, as the previous speaker Ashok has explained, if you suppose send the diagonal basis, you are sending a diagonal state of polarization, and if you are measuring in like linear basis, okay, so equal with equal probability you will be measuring H and V. It's random, you don't know exactly if you are wrongly choosing the basis, linear basis, so you will get random results, sometimes yes, sometimes V, so you don't know exactly what is. Same way if you are sending horizontal, you can with equal probability you will get diagonal and anti-diagonal. So because we are using mutually unbiased basis, this is very important. So projective measurement one basis provides no knowledge of the state in any of the other basis. So you have to have mutually unbiased basis. This is one of the quantum mechanical principles that is being used. So here one thing I should make it clear, I think otherwise I will forget. When we say weak coherent pulse, okay, so this is not a quantum source. Sometimes people write it single photon quantum key distribution. This is not single photon quantum key distribution. Weak coherent pulse is, you can write any, I think any source in terms of quantum states. Okay, even thermal states can be written in terms of quantum state. Okay, like you can say summation of Hrn, Pn, Bra n, Ktn, okay, Pn, Bose-Einstein distribution, like Pn, a probability distribution. So any state, any source can be written in terms of quantum states. So weak coherent pulse also you can write in terms of quantum states. You can use quantum mechanical principles, but weak coherent pulse, in a sense, it's not a quantum source. Okay, it's not a non-classical source. Non-classical source or quantum source is that which you can't explain using classical mechanics. That is a problem. So, and there are certain properties you have to verify to call it non-classical or quantum source, like single photon source. It has anti-bunching, which you can't explain using classical mechanics. That's why it's a quantum source. Similarly, entangled photons, this you can't explain your classical mechanics. That's why, like two photons distance apart, they are entangled, they have very strong collision, that you can't explain the classical mechanics. That's why this is quantum. So this is quantum source. So one should understand difference between quantum source or non-classical source applied and quantum state. So this weak coherent pulse you can write in terms of quantum, but it is not a quantum source applied. Okay. So with this, let me go further. So this has been pointed by Ashok in the previous lecture. So any arbitrary quantum state cannot be cloned. See, you want to clone it, it's impossible. So that is the basic quantum mechanical principle. And that's arbitrary. If you know the quantum state, then you can make a copy. But if arbitrary quantum state, you can't. Secure key generation rate, so you can put a limit on the error, okay, which is not there in the classical thing. Suppose you put this limit, this is a bit error rate. So suppose this error rate is for BB84 protocol. So this is R is the secure key generation rate, and it is given in terms of like binary entropy, okay, binary entropy, probability of happening this event, not happening event. So this binary entropy happening or not happening, that's why binary, just two states are there. So, and if suppose this is 11%, okay, so this key generation rate becomes zero. So you can put a bound on your error rate. That is the beauty. I will show in experiments how you can discard that. If you are getting more error rate, you can discard the key, or whatever key you are getting, you can discard. It shows that some Eve is present, or somebody is hacking. So Ashoka is not, I think he has not shown this picture while talking abbreviated. So this is picture is there all over the internet. But I will explain it again. So here what you are preparing basically, this different polarization is. So this is linear basis, horizontal and vertical polarization. This is diagonal basis, this is diagonal and diagonal. Okay, you have plus 45 minus. And this is randomly you are preparing in this polarization state, and you are sending this over to some party. Alice is sending to Bob, you can say. Okay. And that's what it is being shown here. And Bob measures randomly in two different bases. Okay. So you can assign, like, if it is like horizontal, you can say 0 bit, you can assign, or vertical is 1 bit. Similarly, diagonal, anti diagonal, you can assign 0 and 1. Okay. But it is being shown, you can assign the bit sequence that has been transferred from Alice to Bob. Then this is the sequence. Okay. That's what it is shown again. And then this is the basis sequence. Okay. Now this photon, this belongs to this basis. Okay. You can make out. Okay. And this is cross. This is, so here now Bob is measuring in this basis, randomly is selecting. And if a basis is, then you say ki both are having the same basis. This is like a linear basis. This is diagonal basis, and this fellow, Bob, Alice is saying diagonal, you see here. And this basis is linear basis, horizontal, vertical. So this is 0. If this is linear, both are linear. Okay, this is 1. This again, this is linear, but this is diagonal. Okay. This is diagonal. So this is 1 you are getting, because you can get equal probability. Similarly, here this 0, you are getting 0. So this is diagonal and diagonal diagonal. So it's same basis, you are getting 0. This bit value you have assigned already. So that's how you are getting this detection results. Then you match the basis. If you have selected the right basis, you keep it. If you have selected the, like, both have selected the same basis, you keep it. If both have selected different basis, you discard it. So you can see that the only those keys has been kept where you have same basis, okay? Where basis is matching. So that's how you get the, this key is called shifted key. So that is the BB84 protocol, okay? Prepare and measure. You call it prepare and measure protocol. So which kind of instruments you require for this quantum key distribution? All the instruments are not there, okay? But what basically you do, you have a coherent weak laser pulses. So you have pulse laser, okay? You can make pulse diode lasers, okay? If you are good in electronics, you can make current drivers such that your diode laser becomes pulse, you gives pulses at equal time intervals. And then you attenuate it, okay? Then you attenuate it so that you have per pulse on average less than 1 photon. Or at the maximum 1 photon. So that's what mu Ashok was saying. Mu is equal to mu is around 0.1. So that is called weak, coherent weak laser pulses. So you have made it weak. Then you have heralded single photon source as well as entangled photon source. Okay. So here you use nonlinear crystal. We'll go into a slight more detail later how to produce this entangled photon. So, and as well as this same, this generation nonlinear crystal, and you get these 2 photons, okay? So this can be used for heralded single photon source as well as entangled photons, okay? You can study the polarization correlation, and any variable, as I told earlier, you can study the correlation between variable and say that they are entangled, these photons. And heralded single photon, presence of 1, because you are getting 2 photons at the same time, so presence of 1, that will ensure that another photon is there. So that's how you get heralded. This herald, the presence of 1, so you get heralded single photon. So one of the photons you use, and one you use for heralding to ensure that other is there. So you can have optical fiber or free space, both as I told you. Optical fiber, you can do quantum field distribution as well as free space. You have detectors, avalanche photodiode, single photon detectors, okay, and you have superconducting nanowire single photon detectors. Then transient day sensors are there. There are other detectors also in the market. And depending on the money, you can go for that. These are slightly cheaper, although not so cheap also, around 4 to 5 lakh. And this will cost more than 1 crore. Okay, so depending on money, you can go for that. Of course, you will require a lot of optics. If you want to go for that, you will have a lot of mirrors, filters, interference filters, bandpass filters, lenses, okay, so many things you will require in optics. You will see the setup, although setup does not give all the optics, okay, but the basic you will know. So in VB84, as explained earlier, you can have this kind of problem, okay, because we are using weak coherent pulse. So weak coherent pulse, as we explained you, Poissonian distribution. So there is possibility that along with one photon, some pulses may have more number of photons, two photons. So what this can do, this eavesdropper, what can do, can intercept and reset. So this fellow will measure photons here, okay, correlation state, and then sends it, okay, and then goes to box. So that is one kind of attack. You intercept some of the pulses sent by this, measures them and sends the measured results to box. So this is this doesn't depend like multi photon, this is just intercept and resend attack, okay. But because you have put a bound, okay, and then you can confirm, okay, whether some eavesdropping is made. And this is photon number splitting attack. So you have, as I told, there may be more than one photon per pulse. So one photon bob can have, this eve can have, and then measure, and then single photon blocks all the single photon states sent from ELIS. After quantizing, you can listen to classical channel and can guess the whole queue. Okay, so that's what is the idea. Eve can split like multi photon, take and one photon can keep. Then after listening the classical channel, because you use both quantum and classical channel for basis reconciliation, for matching the basis, you use classical channel like over the phone or internet, whatever you use for matching the basis, that is a classical channel. And when you are sending the quantum state, which is called quantum channel, so there is not like there is nothing like quantum on the in the fiber retained. Okay, same fiber is being used, just you are sending quantum state, or same free space is being used. You call this quantum channel because you're sending quantum state. And when you are talking over phone or internet protocol you are using, or some classical means you are using to communicate, it is a classical channel. So this multi-photon signals can be split by eve and stored in quantum memory. When we talk of this eve or eavesdropper, we assume that eve has all the resources. Okay, so eve can have quantum memory where this quantum state can be safely stored. Okay, so then once using classical channel, eve comes to know about the states, basis one can find. So to check this, Decay state protocol was proposed, okay, to this multi-photon thing, okay, and intercept recent attack also. So in Decay state, what you do, you have a weak coherent pulse as in VB84, okay, and then along with those pulses, like correlation states you are sending, you send some pulses containing no information, no correlation states. So, and they are also sent randomly, okay. And then Bob records the measurement. ELIS publicly announces which are the signal and which are the decay states. And then Bob computes the signal and decay state with transmission, non-transmission probability. You can compute the transmission, the transmittivity of the channel before you start like your quantum key distribution. Once you find out the transmittivity of the channel. That is very simple. You send some light and from one end and measure at another end, and you can, that way you can calculate the transmittivity, how much you have received, how much you have sent, how much you have received. So you should know, so using known transmittivity, BOP computes the signal and decodes it. If the number of decoded states are more or less than the estimated with this transmittivity, okay, the presence of this dropper can be detected. So first we will go for this V92 protocol, okay, where you use only two non-orthogonal states, H and D. These are two bases, linear basis and diagonal and diagonal basis, diagonal basis. And LSE randomly prepares the state in H and D and then sends to BOP to quantum channel, means transmit, that's all these quantum states, collection states of photons. And BOP randomly measures in two bases, H and D, and records the measurement, results of detection. That is, these are the four steps which are followed in V92 protocol. And results of detection in different bases on the key. So you can see here how it is being done in the lab. This is done in the lab. Here we are using FPGA, field programmable gated array device. This is a kind of a board, electronic board, very small electronic board. Okay, number of chips are there. Okay, and this is being used to generate the random numbers and using the linear feedback shift register are being used in this FPGA device. So they are being used, these registers are being used to generate the random numbers. And this is the power supply to the laser diodes, okay? And this is the digital delay generator, okay? You have to keep certain delay, okay? At the same time, you can't both the lasers, okay? One by one, you switch it on. And these are the pulse, these are the pulse lasers, okay, and you can modulate them like these pulses may be like 5 megahertz, 10 megahertz, depending on which kind of laser diode, which kind of current driving circuit you have. You can have 100 megahertz, you can have gigahertz also, okay. So depending on resources you have, you can have this repetition rate of these pulses, okay. 5 megahertz means in 1 second you have 5 megahertz, okay, pulses. So then you have optical attenuator, you have to make the weak coherent pulse, and this is the correlation beam splitter. Ashok has explained what is correlation beam splitter. It splits into this correlation state into H and B. Okay, so this correlation beam splitter, then you have one arm, you will have half a plate because you have to, linear correlation is going to be made into diagonal thing. So you have pair H and B, so H here correlation beam splitters. What it does, it transmits H polarization and reflects B. So you have H here you have prepared, and then you have prepared diagonal H and D. Okay, and then this, sorry, here I have explained slightly. This is quarter wave plate here. Why? So this, basically this whole thing, here. This whole thing, this part, okay, this is being used for this optical attenuation and correlation state preparation. And then you use this, you combine them and send to single mode fiber, okay, in the lab it is being done. And then you, here this is BOP part, this is basically QH2, what is being done in fiber sometimes, what happens, this correlation state changes. So you have to compensate, like what correlation state has changes, you have to compensate that, okay, what is changed while traveling through the fiber. Using this device, quarter half wave plate, half wave plate, quarter wave plate, you can change the, like compensate whatever correlation was initially when you were sending, you can get that correlation. So this fiber, you will have to calculate how much is changing, then accordingly you arrange the orientation of these wave plates and you can. And then you are measuring here, okay? These are the single photon counting modules, APD based single single photon counting diodes, okay? So this is beam splitter, okay? Passively selecting, okay? Splitting into two, then polarization beam splitter, and this PBS, and this half wave plate. So one is diagonal, anti-diagonal basis being measured. Here it is linear basis. So you measure and then you do the basis matching. Okay. Then you do the basis matching, you get the key. So here you see all the parameters for B92 protocol. This is channel transmittivity we are doing in the lab, quite high channel transmittivity, 0.98. Okay, overall detection efficiency, that includes like detectors, quantum efficiency, as well as like loss in the, like here loss is very less, and optical losses also. So optics also create some loss, these polarizers, mirrors, lenses, so many things you use. So there are also, so optical losses will be there because of optics. So roughly you can say 0.4, okay, detection efficiency. Then clock pulse frequency, first thing, synchronization or triggering, you use this clock pulse, okay, so that is around 10 hertz, okay, hertz has come here. So mean photon number pulse is around 0.1, and that you can always calculate. You just have a photo detector, like photon counters, so you measure in 1 second how many counts you are getting, and then you say okay, 5 megahertz, 5 into 10 power 6 pulses are coming, so accordingly you can calculate what is the mean photon number per pulse. Then repetition rate, you know what is your current driving circuit, you know how many pulses you are getting, 5 megahertz per hour diode laser, it's 5 megahertz. And pulses sent per set, okay, because of memory restrictions, you can't very large number of data. So pulses sent per set is around, okay, because of this clock pulse, okay. And this pulse sent, this is basically to save the memory, this clock pulse frequency 10. And so pulses sent per set will be 50,000. So this kind of detection you get, okay. So in Cuber and key rate, okay. So Rocky will be around, Rocky is basically you subtract the background. Background in the sense you will have some stray light, you will have because of at certain temperature, dark counts of the detector itself, that will be around 25 to 50, sometimes even more, and the background spray light. So you detect that, these background counts, so that's what will give you the Rocky. And then you do the basis matching, okay, and with basis matching, you get the shift key. And then you do the error correction, that is low density parity protocol you follow, that's what you have followed, you do the error correction. Then you do the privacy amplification, okay, that is being done by Haspenson and Topolis matrix. So that's what you get basically, and this is the error rate, okay. So you can see that you can divide EB and this RW, so that will be the error rate, and this will be the secret key fraction. So average shift key rate is will be around 58 kb, okay. So here we are seeing shift key rate, but you can do the error correction and privacy amplification. So it will reduce around 60 to 70% reduce. So you will have secure key. This is shift key rate. Then you can have secure key rate slightly lower than 60 to 70% lesser. So this is B92 protocol. I don't know how I'm going in time. So here, that's what I was telling you. So for B92 protocol, this threshold, error threshold is 4.8. And you see here, this is red thing, okay. Here, this error is, Cuber is higher than the 4.8. So you can reject this setup, okay. And you can keep the others where it is less than 4.8. So now we go for the BB84 protocol. Just here you have driving electronics as explained in the B92 and RNG how you, and then time tagger, okay. In LS side as well as box side, time tagging is very important. You have to match the timing. And then for polarization state, okay. You create and combine, and then you have quantum channel as well as this classical channel, okay. And Bob is having collection optics, population state analysis, you have to measure population states, and single photon counting module, as well as both are having time tag. So time tagging is very important to match the pulses or the to measure the same photon which is being sent by the ALIS. Okay, I'm not. So, let me see. So this is basically a secretariat fraction for single photon. When you have, like, when we assume that there is only single photon, okay? So this is the binary entropy I have already told this thing, okay? So this is the secret key by the total shift key. This is secret key, this is the shift key. So, and shift key generation rate is given by this formula, okay? Quantum beat error rate, everything is like, and then you have shift key rate, is given in terms of mu, transmittivity of the channel, Q. Q is basically shift factor, you call, because we're using this beam splitter 50-50, that's why it is half here. And then you have eta CH, this channel transmittivity. I told you how to calculate that. And then you have eta detector. Then this is the detection efficiency, okay, of the detection system. Then this is F rate. So this is the repetition rate of the laser you are sending pulses. So this is repetition rate of the pulses. Then you have a secret key rate fraction for when you are using weak coherent pulse. So you have to account only for single photon pulses, that's why you multiply with Q1. Okay, when you are using, because you may have multi photon pulses also, and then you subtract multi photon contribution, and that you take care in privacy implementation. Is multi photon there also. So this is the setup again, similar setup, but here instead of two laser diodes, earlier B92, you have four laser diodes, okay? And then you combine here in beam splitter, okay? Half wave plate are there. Then this is kind of a reference laser, a Bacon laser, aligning laser, whatever you call Bacon laser, aligning laser, whatever. So this is almost same wavelength we use, like here we are using around 800 nanometer, this laser diode, and same kind of wavelength we use for aligning also, similar, you can use different also, helium neon also you can use. So that's how you align everything, okay, launching optics, okay, some lenses you use, okay, two lenses you use, you collimate them and send it to Bob. So this Bob is receiving from ALIS, same way you collect also two lenses, okay, here, then here, similar kind of setup as you have seen for Bob. This is beam splitter, polarizing beam splitter, halfway plate, okay. Then you measure in linear basis, diagonal and diagonal basis. And here, I will show you the setup. So here, we are measuring in oscilloscope, okay. We are, and then you can match the basis and you can get. So this is the transmitter part, ALIS, that's what it looks like, and this is the receiver, this is Sarika doing the experiment, okay, on the terrace. So this is the real setup, that's what it looks like, okay. And this is the terrace of our building, okay, that's where we are doing the experiment. So students were enjoying doing field experiment whole night. They were doing the experiments since morning or since evening till like 6 a.m. in the morning. So they continued for 2 days and got good data. So this is the transmitter, ALIS here, and we have one like 100 meters away. We have another building. This is on the, these two cabins are on the terrace of our building where our labs are there. And then we have another building 100 meters apart. That is the limitation. We could have gone for higher distances, but we have only two buildings in our campus where line of sight is available, and that another building is only 100 meters away. So we put a reflector here, and then this mirror basically, and then we got this reflected like that. So that makes it 200 meters. And so we are doing basically 200 meter quantum key distribution in the field. Okay. And the one thing I must tell you here, this the post we made. Okay, you can see this post. So when wind started, we are doing experiment March, it was fine. When it came to April, this summer onset, and at night this wind started blowing. And when wind started blowing, this whole thing, this post started vibrating. So when we were making, we didn't notice this part. This is very around 12 feet high, and these are the stairs to go there to keep the mirror. So at that time we didn't realize. So once you start doing experiment in the field, then only you know that what are the problems you will face. Okay. So now we are making it arrangements to fix it so that it does not vibrate when the wind starts going. Okay, so, and one more thing I think didn't tell you, when we are doing this experiment in the field, we realized that we have to use metallic mirrors, okay, long distance, so because we are getting some phase errors, okay, and we are not getting the right results. So even mirror, which kind of mirror we're using, that makes a lot of difference. So you have to use metallic mirrors if you want to evaluate this phase difference between H and V, horizontal vertical correlation, when you're using diagonal and antidiagonal. So these things are very important. Sometimes just lenses becomes very important, okay, how you are collimation, which kind of lens system you are using, which kind of focal length we are using. So everything is important, starting from lens, mirror, and your detection. Everything is important. You can't say key lenses are just one thing, very small. So everything is important when you are doing the experiment. So that's what the results are there. You have this X-ray signal, and you are here. You see, because 200 meters, so this reflected signal you will get only after certain time. So that's the delay time. Okay, you have setting delay time like 639 nanosecond delay from ELIS when ELIS sends as correlation. Laser diode, this from laser diode, and Bob receives. So this is 639 nanosecond. So accordingly you set, and then you integration time for 10 nanoseconds. Okay. You take the data. Okay, and actual signal temporal window is 1 nanosecond. Okay. So delay is into this, you see delay, okay, and your temporal window is only 1 nanosecond, okay. So that to avoid the stray line, okay, you get the right thing only. If you increase this, you will see that it will be reducing. If you are sending H and measuring H, okay, so you will have this kind of thing. Others, this is just error. These things are just errors. Okay, so when H is being sent and Bob is measuring H, so that's what it is. So this is a 1 nanosecond window, and this integration time is 10 millisecond. Okay, it's written. So again, this you see, when H is ELIS is sending horizontal polarization, but Bob is using this measuring V polarization. So R is error. Okay, this is actual time. So that's what. Okay, you will get this much something. So the same way you when H and measuring D, you will have H polarization laser diode to Bob, and Bob is measuring D. So equal thing. If you are measuring H, that's what mutually unbiased basis. So you will have equal for D and A. Okay, that's what you will get. So that's what you see here. You are getting almost equal there. Okay, numbers are important. Just see the real numbers here. This Y axis. Okay. Okay. So that's how you can guess. Don't confuse. The numbers are important here. Okay. So that's how you get the data. And that is the table. So what you have here, we have, because we are doing in the field, we have keep mean photon number 0.3, and we have measured this channel transmittivity 0.7. And overall detection efficiency, again, we have kept 0.4 only. And same laser diodes which we are using in the lab for B92 we have used. So this is the thing we get, okay, transmitted. And these are the detected. This is the Rocky and safety. And these are the error bit. So this is the average safety rate. That's what we get, 210 around, okay? And then we get the secure accepted key rate after this error correction and privacy implementation. So that is the BB84. Now I come to the quantum entanglement. Like as I told in the beginning, you can use weak warrant pass as well as entangled photons for quantum key distribution. Okay, so quantum entanglement, I think you must be hearing a lot of talks already. This workshop is started, I think, 14th. So basics of quantum entanglement you have heard. So I will not go into too much of detail. So particles, wave function, how you define this quantum entanglement between two particles? Particle wave functions cannot be separated. Suppose you have two particles form a system. So this wave function, if you write in terms of the psi is equal to psi 1, psi 2, so psi 1 and psi 2, they cannot be separated. Measurement of one particle affects the state of the other, and no classical model of this behavior. You can't explain this measurement of one particle affecting the other. You can't explain classical. So basically, this is the source. You can have correlated electrons, you can have correlated photons, or whatever, correlated atoms. Okay, so they can be entangled. And then here is the electron, you are measuring a spin. Okay, so any variable you can use, polarize and spin, orbital momentum, linear momentum, whatever, there are so many. And out of all this polarization, when we come to quantum communication or quantum key distribution, we use polarization of light. Okay, like photons, we use photons, and this polarization is very you can easily handle when it comes to photons. Okay, you can manipulate polarization using half wave plate, quarter wave plates, or polarizing beam splitters. So this property can be handled easily. So that's why the most common method to generate entangled photons in the lab is the spontaneous parametric down conversion. So what is a spontaneous parametric down conversion? This Anand Jha, along with his students from IIT Kanpur, I think he will be giving talk in this workshop very soon. So they have written very good article, okay, General of Optics. You can read that for getting the details of this SPDC and how you produce entangled photons. And our student Ali Anwar, along with Thomas Zenevian, Alex Ding, and Chitra Bhanu, again our student. So they have also one review article in Review of Scientific Instruments. Very nice article, okay, entangled photon pair source. So for more details, you can read these articles. So you see that we are not very bad when it comes to understanding and doing experiments in quantum science and technology. Of course, we are behind compared to developed world, okay, compared to Europe and US, but we can catch, okay, we should not be disappointed, we should not be disheartened that we are very far behind, we can't. So people are working and they are doing good work. Okay. So pump laser is there. So this is Sky 2 crystal with this is a frequency and this is wave vector. So this in spontaneous parametric down conversion, what happens? Single photon, okay, breaks into two photons, signal and idler. Generally, signal beam is by convention. By convention, you low omega is called, I think, is written low omega. Generally, signal beam is called high omega, okay, high frequency. It's just convention. Some people make call it the low also. So one you call high frequency or high energy signal and lower idler, or other way also, depends on. So, but signal idler, there are two photons, okay? One breaks into two. This pump breaks into two, you have signal idler, and it has to energy has to be conserved and momentum has to be conserved. This basic laws has to be conserved. So that's what it shows. Energy pump photon, energy has to be conserved, momentum has to be conserved. Okay. So that's what it shows. And this is called phase matching condition. So phase matching ensures that you get the energy in a particular direction. Okay. So more like conversion, efficient conversion, and that is channelized in a particular direction. So that phase matching condition ensures. So that's why you get like crystals, optic axis on a particular direction. That you select a crystal like that. So here again, our student at PRN, Jabir, has worked on this entangled photon source, okay, published in 2017. So what he what has been done here, and this is the very compact version of the this, less than 1 feet by 1 feet by 1 feet. So very compact, it is being developed for payload in satellite. So here we have PP KTP crystals. You can have all sorts of crystals. Okay, this is periodically cold KTP, potassium tetrahydrate phosphate. So, and you have to control the temperature of that crystal. So you, here we are using PPKTP. You can have BBO crystals. You can have all sorts of PLN, lithium niobate. So there are many large number of like non-lithium crystals you can use. So here we are using PPKTP. And we change the temperature, and I didn't tell you SPDC here. So you can have SPDC, you can have collinear. So signal idler can be collinear or non-collinear, and they can have like degenerate, non-degenerate. You can have like same frequency or same wavelength or down convert photons, or you can have different. Then you can have type 1 phase matching, you can have type 2 phase matching, you can have type 0 phase matching, type 1 phase matching when you have like polarization of pump photon is like H, and it converted down convert photons having polarization V. Okay, diagonal like orthogonal to each other. Orthogonal pump is orthogonal to down convert photons. But type 2, you have like down convert photons are orthogonal polarization. So H, it may be H, but this down current photons pump may be H, down current photons may be H and V. So and type 0 all are same polarization. Okay, so you can have different kind of phase matching. You can have collinear, non-collinear. So here it is the non-collinear, you see down conversion. You have blue diode laser, okay, 405, that is the pump, okay, and this is going through the crystal. And it is being down converted. The blue is getting 810, 405 is getting 810. This is degenerate, non-collinear. Okay. And this is type 0. Okay, phase matching. And then that's why you are using dual lambda by 2 plate and dual PBS. Dual means it works for two wavelengths, for 810 as well as 405. Similarly, dual, it works for polarizing means it works for 405 as well as 810. Okay. So so using this lambda by 2 plate and PBS, you make them like HH and VV, and that's what you are getting the polarization, this entangled state, okay? So here, what kind of entangled state you are getting? 1 by root 2 HH plus VV. And then you do the analysis to confirm that this is the entangled photon. So how you do the analysis? So you measure basically this, as you saw that analyzer, this basically polarizers, two polarizers. So you keep at different angles, okay? And these are the correlation coefficients here, okay? This is the Bell parameter or CHS parameter, CHS Bell parameter. Okay, this CHS is like, these are the name of scientists, okay? First names of first letters of the names of scientists, and Bell violation, Bell inequality, you know, you must have heard of it. So you must have heard. So this correlation coefficient you calculate by doing this coincidence counting. Okay, so you keep this polarizer and analyzer at different angles, alpha alpha dash, beta beta dash, one side alpha alpha dash, other side beta beta dash. That's the notation you have used. So then you use this correlation coefficient. Okay, by doing this coincidence counting, this is alpha means now at perpendicular angle you are keeping. Okay, first you select alpha angle, then perpendicular, and then you do the coincidence counting using SPCM. Okay, means two photons stitching together in the counter. So, and then you calculate this correlation coefficient. Okay, and from that correlation coefficient, you get the this parameter. And if parameter is more than 2, means it is violated. Well, inequality is violated. If it is less than, it's classical. If it is more than 2, it's violated. That's how you get the Bell's inequality violation, and you can confirm that it's entangled. So that's what it has been measured. You see with this analyzer angle, okay, and then you fix this angle, and you see this interference kind of thing, quantum interference, okay, interference fringes. And this visibility should be more than 70% if you want to get this Bell inequality violation. So that's what it is, and we get very good value for parameters 2.60, you see, for single mode fiber, multimode fiber. Of course, we're collecting more all sorts of modes, so inequality becomes S parameters becomes less, okay, and here it's quite stable, okay, and this is shows quantum spectrometry also. Fidelity you have calculated, fidelity is 0.975, very good fidelity. So similar kind of setup, this entangled photon source is being developed for quantum satellite. I think I am taking too much time, maybe 5 minutes, so 15 minutes will be there for questions. So this is BBM92 protocol, similar to BB84 protocol. You see this Ellis and Bob, this entangled photon source, two photons are going here, and then different bases they select, and then do the measurement, similar bit value assign to different correlation state. You do the measurement, do the shifting, and it's a similar kind of measurement as you do in BB84, and you get the key. So here you have entangled photon source. This is quantum channel because you are sending entangled photons, and then you have collecting optic phosphides, and this is for basis frequency. So this is the optical setup here. Okay, to Bob here. This is entangled photon source, the same entangled photon source I discussed. Okay, and here these two photons, one is going to Ellis, one is going to Bob. Okay, this is from Ellis, Bob. So yeah, what we are doing, so reflected part, so different cabin, this Ellis and Bob is sitting in different cabin, and that's what we do. So this is setup here. Here this is the entangled photon source, this is going here, this is coming to Ellis, this entangled photon source, one is coming to Ellis here on the same board, and then it is going to through the window, it's going and reflected, and it's coming to Bob. Okay, and all the measurements, they are being fed to the these detectors, signals or SPCM signals are being fed to oscilloscope to generate the field. So that's the field result. So we get this Bell parameter, entanglement distribution. You have to check first, you are getting entangled photons or not after 200 meters. So we have checked. So Bell parameter is coming very nice, much, much larger than the 2.54. Okay. And this is very nice visibility we get for H, P, D, and A. Okay. You see here, using this correlation coefficient, you can measure those things. Okay. And then similar to BB84, as I told, it's BBM92 is quite similar. So you have a correlation count, coincidence count window is 1 nanosecond here also, but integration time is more. We have there it was 10 millisecond, here is 40 millisecond, because we have less entangled photon, you don't generate at such a large numbers. Okay. Still, there are limitations. That's why most popular is BB84 protocol and Dicastet protocol, because you can't generate entangled photons at very large numbers. So, and then again, this delay time, Here it is 648 nanosecond because we are using 200 meters around. Slightly shifted cables, so that's why it's slightly different from BB84 protocol, and then that's what you get, and then these are the errors. So this is the parameters for BB92, general transmittivity same terrace we are using, same reflectors, everything. So background coincidence. So, and then you get the HBND results. You can match HH and this, all this matching you have to do. So after matching, you get these numbers, and that gives you around 5 kbps, okay, 5 kilobits per second, and QBR is around 4%, okay, so that's one. Then one can go for satellite anyway, so similar as I told, satellite you can give this BB84 setup, okay, and then you have to use, when you go for satellite, one has to use telescope, okay, to beam. If you are using entangled photons, you have to have two telescopes, okay, because you are sending to two stations. Okay, if you are sending BB84, you combine all the states in a single channel as you have seen earlier. So one telescope is good enough. And then RF, this classical channel, is done by this radio frequency communication. So, and this is all electromagnetic wave travel at the same speed. So this is the classical channel through RF link, and this is the light, okay, optical channel, okay. So this is the satellite diagram. Then you have optical ground station. So for, again, you have to use this telescope to receive the signal. Of course, satellite, you can't use the big telescope. There you use around 20 to 30 centimeter telescope, okay, one or two, whatever. Then at ground you have to have, because it's coming from satellite around 600 kilometers or 800 kilometers away, so natural divergence, it follows light and it becomes broadened. So then you have to use bigger telescope here, and then same way you do the analysis, everything, okay. And of course you have to do the time synchronization. The same thing which you have sent, you are measuring the same thing, so you have to do time synchronization, okay. So that's how you generate the key using satellite. So here is the summary. Calculate the shift key rate and secure key rate for BB84 protocol we have, and then we have checked entanglement distribution, okay, over 200 meters, and this entangled photon we have used for secure generating quantum keys, and we are getting 5 kilobits per second, and secure key rate, of course, it will be less than like 60 to 70% after doing this error correction and this privacy amplification. So that's what we are getting. And future, what we want to do, we effect of turbulence and how to mitigate it for terrestrial communication, that's what we want to study in the field. Then simulating conditions for uplink and downlink, to check the key rate for satellite-based quantum communication, which is better. You can simulate, you can make a sale, okay, with a flight parameter, fixed flight parameter, okay. And then you can put the near to the LS or near to the BOF cabin to simulate uplink and downlink. And then making device-independent protocol, BBM92, how we can make, using BBM92, because we get higher keys, so how we can convert this BBM92 as device independent protocol. So means increasing the key rate and making it a device independent protocol, how to increase. Then we want to use like vertex beam, pencil beam, as I have not talked about vertex beam. Nirmalya told I have a lot of work using vertex beams. So, but there are many structured light beams. So, okay, pencil beam, Gaussian cell model beam, twisted Gaussian cell model beam. So, how they can be used for robust and secure key distribution? That is also one of our plan. In fact, when I was showing my slide to one of my students, so he told me that this time you are not using orbital momentum anywhere. I don't see in your slide. So. With these words, I will stop, and you are free to ask questions. Okay, fine. Thank you. Hello. Ah, then Sambhav Bulia. these are the hazards of online. You will keep getting calls. Okay. So let me check the questions online.
See, Nirmalya might have gone to our department. There was a meeting today.
Okay, no problem. Okay. So this is online. Yeah. All these things will happen. Yeah. You will get calls. Somebody Aradhyar. Will come for signing.
Yeah. Why don't you, Aradhyar, feed him the questions? Yeah.
It's so, if it is measured and cloned, wouldn't the quantum state would be lost? Cloning you can't do as measured. Once you have measured, then it is lost. Okay, that's right. And then you can't clone. That's the thing. Okay, this question is from Baljinder. Once you have measured, you have lost the state. Or you have to do quantum non-demolition measurement if you want to keep the state. Okay. But that is measurement, okay, you can't known. So Ajay Samuel, why do we use CAPTCHA code? Is the fear of diffusion of PQ, I think that these questions are from for Ashok, not for me, I think.
Yeah. So there is a question for you, sir. How will Bob know which basis is used by Ellis? This question is by Sohan Kulkarni.
Could you please repeat the question?
The question is, how will Bob know which basis is used by Ellis?
How they communicate through phone or internet. So this is, that's what is classical channel is very important, classical communication. Both say ki this is the basis we have used. Okay.
So there is another question by Deepan.
What is that question?
Could the decay pulse interact with the entangled photon, hence interfering with the entangled photon and the signal?
Decay pulse, what?
Decay pulse.
When you are decay state protocol is basically when you are using weak current pulse. So in one should not mix, like when you are using entangled photons, there is no decay thing. Okay, because entangled photon itself is like random. And it's quite secure when you are using entangled photon, okay? So you don't need to have decay, because decay came to avoid that attack, like photon number splitting attack, intercept recent attack, these kind of attacks to avoid decay state protocol came for BBAT4 to make it more. But here we are using entangled photon. So one should not mix like entangled photon and decay thing, okay?
Okay. So there is one more question by Narsimha. Can we arbitrarily increase the intensity of single photons? Are these single photons distinguishable or indistinguishable?
Single photons, you can't increase arbitrarily, as I told, this present method, like which is most popular. You can't increase arbitrarily, single photon at least, because heralding. So it will depend on this efficiency of the down conversion. So, and they have not very high efficiency for down conversion. Okay. So it will depend on the down conversion efficiency. It is heralding, basically, SPDC, if you're using SPDC. But there are other techniques also, but again, there is limitation. You can't increase arbitrarily this, like number of photons per second, single photon.
There is a question by Sushma Hari Prasad. So you want to ask how much background noises should be taken into consideration as an affecting factor for the communication in free space?
So background, you have to, it's better to have less background, but you can always take into account this background thing and you can subtract. So before you do the real communication, you start sending your quantum states. Are communicating with quantum states, you have to record the background, okay, and then you can do the subtraction, whatever you are getting, okay. So that's how you can subtract the background. But in principle, you have to have as much low you can keep, you should divide the background.
So there is a question by Sanjay De. We want to ask about this. Does entangled molecules exist? Entangled molecules exist.
Entangled molecules?
Yeah.
Entangled molecules, at least I have not heard, but in principle, you may have entangled atoms, entangled molecules, but like quantum dots, you have entangled quantum dots. So why not entangled molecules? They are thinking of molecular qubit. Okay, once you have qubit, so like you have entangled qubit, molecular qubits are quite robust. So although I have not gone into much detail using molecules, but you can have like molecules entangled also, because you can talk of molecular qubit. Already they are talking of molecular qubit.
So there is a question by Jairin. How does Eve store quantum states like photons in quantum memory?
How this quantum memory?
Yeah, does Eve stores quantum states like photons in quantum memory?
Quantum memory is there are two kinds of quantum memories. You have crystal based as well as atomic system based. Atomic vapors, okay. So, and mechanism will be different in both. Like how to store the given photon state, okay. So, and this is there are many number of techniques, okay. And all the techniques will have different mechanisms to store and retrieve, okay. So it's a quite a vast topic, quantum memory. Depending on the technique we're using, depending on the material we're using, it will be different, okay. But you can store, yeah.
There is one more question, Kamlesh. What wavelengths are more useful in satellite communication?
What wavelengths are more useful? Right now, they are using around 800 nanometer. That is the only satellite, BCS, a Chinese satellite. They are using 850 nanometer for BB84 and for 810 for entangled photon. Okay. But in principle, one can use 1550 communication wavelength ranges also, okay. Because there you have window, 1550 nanometer also. But problem is detectors are quite costly, quite bulky and quite costly, because you need this dilution thing. You have to keep them at very low temperature, this kind of superconducting thing. So you have to keep it at very low temperature. So they become very bulky and very costly. So that is the only limitation. Otherwise, one can use 1550 also. Okay.
So I think there is a last question by Mrinal Thapa. The question is, if Alice and Bob communicate through classical channels, can Eve obtain important information before Bob through these channels and tamper with the key?
That's what this quantum channel, classical channels are different. Suppose somebody has no control over quantum channel and just classical channel, so Eve cannot do anything. Okay, once listening through classical channel. One should have quantum, some device to take this quantum states also, information about the quantum states being exchanged. Then only one can do. Just by classical, you can't do.
There is one question for large distances of signal transportation. Is there any interference due to Earth's magnetic field?
Earth's magnetic field? That I have not think, I have not thought of, or I have not anywhere I have encountered this kind of thing, but one can think of how to take into account this magnetic field.
Yeah.
I don't see immediately it will magnetic field, Earth's magnetic field affecting the secure communication. But one will have to think. I can't answer it.
One more question. Yeah. In the equation where upper value are odd.
What value?
See, I am not able to understand. Vatsala, Saxena. In the equation where upper value are odd and then substitute two times, but lower value are all are odd. I don't understand.
I don't understand this question really. I also don't understand what is the meaning.
Achha, we'll, if she writes it properly, we'll consider.
Yeah.
Achha, Sohan Kulkarni, can quantum vertices be used instead of photons to communicate through the quantum channel?
Quantum vertices can be used. So, in principle, it can be used, this quantum states of vertices, okay. It can be used, but this measurement vertices measurement becomes slightly tricky. That's why they are not getting popularity. But in principle, it can be used.
Achha, something like, you know, a related question, something like Airy beam.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you, is it possible to have like one photon kind of thing or?
Yeah, that's what in Gautam's lab they are trying to make down converted photons. So they are making this Airy beam, single photon.
Okay.
Airy beam, yeah. Vertex, anyway, you know that what it says, OM states can be done in single photon. So, similar way, they are going for Airy modes.
So yeah, I think that was the last question. And just, you know, RPG, let me ask you, where are we right now? I mean, for example, you know, is ISRO close to developing something? You guys are actively involved in something, or what is?
Like, as I told, this field thing we have done. Okay, now we have to go for this rotating platform, and so that we can extract the key. And then we can go for satellite thing. Of course, we can start preparing for satellite thing. In the meantime, before we go for satellite, we can test it for longer distances. But principles remain same, basically, not different.
So you are now able to communicate between PRL and our Thaltej.
Thaltej, PRL, and this Prasanji, this is my office is now, my lab is in Thaltej itself. So we have one new building, along with this astrophysics building. We have another building which is around 100 meters away. That's what it is being shown here. So this is the new building, there is a new building where my lab is there. My lab is on second floor, and Gautam's lab is on the ground floor. And this is astrophysics building, 100 meters away.
Okay.
So this is terrace of astronomy astrophysics building. This is, we call Thaltej new building.
Okay.
So when you are doing free space, it has to be line of sight should be there.
Yes.
So that is the only building which is like line of sight is available. So that limits the distance. Otherwise, we could have gone for longer distance and we can test. But I think principles will remain same. You have to increase the delay. That's all. Mm-hmm.
So very nice.
Delay I showed the 680 nanosecond. That delay will increase depending on the distance. So that delay you have.
So hello Prashanta, can I ask a question? Can
sure,
I
couple? Sure.
Yeah.
Hello RP.
Yes.
Hello, can you hear
Professor
me?
Om, I can hear you.
Yeah, good afternoon.
So I have a couple of questions. One, I am curious about your that work you did, which is in the archive I find in 2020 about the QPD with multi-photon pulses, where you reported that you obtained a higher secure key rate over decoy state protocol.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what is the status of that work? Because I have seen last the archive version in 2020. So, because there was no security discussion in that paper.
We have submitted it. We have revised it. It's with referees again.
Okay.
Certain questions. So it is with referees. Let's see.
It's an interesting. But one point about that, there was no discussion about security in that paper. Because how the QBR and all those, you get a higher security
We are putting, some discussion about the security also we are putting in that.
Okay. So the papers you mentioned in your talk about Journal of Optics 2020 and Review of Scientific Instruments 2021, do they discuss any of these experiments also that you are doing?
No, that is limited to like entangled photons, SPDC and all those things. They don't discuss about this quantum key distribution
experiments. So these experiments are discussed in any paper?
Experiments are discussed regarding entangled photon generation there.
Okay.
Not about the quantum key distribution.
And the experiments performed in your lab. Yeah. So, yeah. So they are not discussed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor.
Thanks.
Okay, RPG, so thanks a lot. Very
thank you, Prashant ji. Thank you.